Madhouse, this is...
That's a fun house. That's what the crack is. What are you adjusting the microphone for? It's all right.
It's all in the wrong way.
What do you mean? No, it's
good. How was your weekend, Lee?
Good. It was good. We had a big celebration yesterday. Donegal Down Syndrome had us all out for the big feed and the silver tassie. And it was just great to sit down and get the big feed and then not wash up
What dishes. Did you have?
I had turkey and ham.
Lovely.
Turkey and ham. And then what did I have?
Stuffing?
No, gluten-free. No stuffing.
Oh, sorry, I forgot
about it. But no, it's all right. But it was fantastic. Fair play to the tassie. Always put out good feed. And then what we had dessert afterwards. And sure, there was great crack. And it was just nice.
Were you working at all or just
No, sitting
relaxing?
At the table.
Brilliant. Isn't that nice? Yeah.
It was nice to see so many members in one place together because we might bump into a few of them.
I get you,
but it's nice when people travel and get
together.
And
for a lot of people too, it takes an awful lot of planning to be available for that day.
Well, you know yourself, if you have young ones or older ones, do you know, to get out of the house to be at a certain time. Like if I says, Greg, be here now for 2 o'clock and you're taking all Hudson and the whole crew with you, you have to get your accoutrements together.
I was thinking you're looking fulfilled and fresh, so you're well fed at the task.
Oh, sure, it was great.
Did you go into the spa?
No, it did not. I'll leave that to you. No, but it was good. Do you know what I mean? Just nice to sit
Excellent.
Down.
Lovely.
So it was lovely. Brilliant. Do you know good when you can be relaxed and enjoy it?
Yeah, of course.
And then what about you? Would you do much?
Nothing.
Nothing. That's good.
In a great way. Like it was fine.
But so, do you chilled. Know sometimes, oh, were you up too much? You don't have to be up too much. Do you know the
sometimes
weekends?
It's nice not to do anything.
To have no plans.
Just touring around and visiting and stuff, but you know, nothing.
But sure, we don't have to be doing stuff sometimes.
I had a toasted sandwich. That's about the height of it.
Yeah, did you make it yourself?
Oh.
What are you cooking this way? I've seen you put up more. You're looking
I made chocolate brownies there at the weekend.
Did you? How did they go down? Good.
Lovely. I don't really eat them because I don't have a sweet tooth, but yeah, no.
Good.
Positive reaction.
You like the old bacon now? You're getting
oh,
into
I,
that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Good, man.
Yeah. That's I still nice. Have to make your gluten-free scones.
No, you'll not make them. There's a Marade girl over...
No, there's a couple of people text me, right, on the QT. And this is... It's kind of funny because they text me privately to tell me... I swear to you, I will make them next week, right, for you. But they text me to say that in Strabane, there's a mix that you can get.
No, I heard about that.
Right, okay, but listen, the point is it's not that. But they were sort of telling me... On the Q2 so I could pretend I made them.
Right.
So me and the listeners are in cahoots, you see.
Cahoots? Well, tell me this now. Say you happen to come in and surprise me, Lee. I made these lovely, fluffy scones for you.
Yeah.
And then I take them home and then we're eating them. And then I think, right?
Yeah.
And then I have to, can I just say, oh, they were lovely, Greg? Or do
no,
I have
you have to be honest. No, the whole
were,
fun of that
were
is
like,
that you,
like rocks.
Exactly. The whole fun of that would be like, oh, I'm sorry. It's typical of the
We need somebody else that's, no, to be fair, right? We need to give it, we need to have somebody else on the panel, the gluten-free panel. So, you know, because.
So a non-gluten.
No,
so
no.
So someone who's not gluten intolerant.
Oh, that would be a good idea. Oh, okay. Well, so me and Caroline and somebody
we'll make
else.
A feature
three people.
Out of it.
Well, me, Caroline and somebody else in here.
Okay.
And we better go because the news is going to be late.
Yep.
Have a good day.
All right then, Lee. Take care of yourself. Thanks so very much indeed. It is 9:03. That's all going to be set up for next week. Let's get a news update. And it's over to Michaela Clark.
Thanks, Greg. Good morning. The new Fine Gael leader will sit down with current senior ministers from the party in the coming weeks to outline what priorities can be addressed. Simon Harris ran unopposed in the race to be the new leader and will meet with his predecessor and current Taoiseach Leo Varadkar today. He has already said he wants the government to go to its full term, which would mean no general election until around a year from now. Simon Harris says that's because the government has more work to do.
In terms of implementation of the programme for government, one of the very first questions I'll be asking as the leader of Fine Gael is for a breakdown as to exactly where we're at on implementation. These are commitments that the three parties made and agreed. How are we getting on in relation to it and what's our shared view of what progress we can make?
The future of people living in defective block social properties remains uncertain. Councillor Liam Blaney says some minor repair works were carried out a number of years ago, but since then there has been a lack of communication with the inhabitants. He's urging Donegal County Council to step in while they await a scheme to remediate the social homes.
There has been some houses where the houses had been patched temporarily. That's incredible for a while until the new scheme was announced. But unfortunately, that new scheme hasn't been announced yet. And some of the houses that has been patched up is deteriorating at a very rapid rate. And even as far as whether water come back into them again, I've called the council to try and see if they can accommodate these people that are living in these conditions, that they go out right away and then remediate the house temporarily again or to move them into their properties. But look, we're waiting far too long on a social housing scheme to be announced and long overdue, and I do hope it is announced very shortly.
Donegal is the cheapest county for housing, while Dublin remains the most expensive place in Ireland to buy a house. The figures contained in the Irish Independent, or EA, Average House Price Index show the national average price of a three-bed semi-detached is around €308,000. Average prices in Donegal are €162,500, up 1.6% in the last 3 months. It's in stark contrast to an average asking price of over €517,000 in Dublin. There's calls for Donegal County Council to develop a town plan for Convoy. Councillor Patrick McGowan believes the growth of population in the town warrants a review of infrastructure. He says Convoy is acting as a satellite town for Letterkenny and the expansion of it must be plan-led. Councillor McGowan says a review of Convoy is vital.
Because of the amount of development that's even proposed there at the moment, there's an urgent need to have a town plan, to have some kind of a strategy about where the houses should go and what kind of services is there. And this is about creches, schools, about everything else.
Weather now mostly cloudy today with outbreaks of rain and drizzle becoming lighter and patchier as the day goes on. Highest temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees. That's all from Highland Radio News for now. We'll be back with news again at 10 o'clock. Until then, good morning.
At the Irish Independent, we don't just report the news, we tell the stories written all over Ireland. After all, each struggle, triumph, high and low, leaves a mark that lasts. Irish Independent, written all over Ireland.
And now, it's time for the talk of the Northwest. The 9 to Noon Show with Greg Hughes on Highland Radio.
Hello, good morning to you. It's 6 minutes past nine on this Monday, the 25th of March, 2024. And it's the start of another week here on the 9 to Noon Show. How are you all keeping? I hope you had a lovely weekend or best a weekend you can have. If you were working, I hope it went okay for you. But anyway, we want you with us for the next three-odd hours. So we've got lots lined up on the show today. Jam-packed full of different items that hopefully will keep you informed, keep you entertained. We want your views, your comments, your suggestions, whatever it might be, to 086 60 25000. That's a WhatsApp and text number. You can send your WhatsApp voice notes to that number as well, by the way, if that suits you better than texting. And if you want to give us a call, it's 074 91 25000, and emails come in to us at comments@highlandradio.com. You can watch the programme as well. We're on Facebook, Highland Hub, Highland News and Sport. You can watch us on your big screen TV or your Fire Stick on YouTube, Highland Radio Ireland. We're streaming worldwide too on the X platform. Don't be afraid to say hello wherever you're watching us from, or in fact to interact with us on the socials as well. Right, let's look at the front of some of the papers this morning. The Derry People Donegal News. Sinn Féin leader Mary Lou MacDonald is demanding that the government immediately release €1 million in funding to rebuild Rafoe Community Playgroups facility. It's emerged that Rafoe Preschool, which currently meets the needs of 46 toddlers, is set to be demolished as it was built using defective concrete blocks. The school is only 22 years old. Deputy MacDonald was speaking to the Donegal News during a whistle-stop visit to the county on Saturday. She was in the county as a show of support to the party's local TD Piers Doherty and Padraig McLaughlin, as well as Sinn Féin's local election candidates. Okay, so we'll see what she delivers if in power. The great list is getting longer and longer and longer. The Derry News this morning. A new task force has been announced to develop a plan to almost double the student population at the Ulster University's McGee campus. There are currently just over 5,000 students at the campus in Derry. On Friday, Economy Minister Conor Murphy launched a task force to develop and oversee an action plan to expand numbers to 10,000. It follows a commitment to expand the campus in the 2020 New Decade, New Approach deal, which would be a significant doubling. Well, no surprise to me, as you may have heard me waffling last week, no one decided to throw their hat into the ring. So Simon Harris is the new Fine Gael leader, and he will be ratified as Taoiseach. I don't know in this situation if they have to buy off the, negotiate with the independents, but he needs those numbers to be ratified because it is the Dáil that makes the decision. He's pictured on the front of the page showing attitude. He is angry and he's pointing his finger out. And I suppose maybe too, he wants to early on show more of his character. Well, anyway, new Fine Gael leader and presumptive Taoiseach Simon Harris has signalled no snap general election and that the government will run its full term until early next year. Speaking following the formal announcement of his unopposed election at a party conference in Athlone, Mr Harris said he would meet Fine Gael ministers in the cabinet to set priorities what can be delivered in their areas in the remaining lifetime of the government. In a speech to party activists and members following his election yesterday, Mr Harris said that under his leadership, Fine Gael would stand for supporting business, especially small businesses, and for making work pay. He also said the party stands for law and order on the side of An Gada Síochána Síochána, where our streets are safe and crime is never allowed to go unchecked. He also said he would seek to move from an emergency response to the migration crisis to a more planned, sustainable model, to a fair and firm system when it comes to migration. Okay, so as I say, he's looking quite stern on the front of the paper there. On to the Irish Independent now. This was referenced by Michaela in the news. House prices increased in Ireland's most affordable counties. They soared by up to three times above the national average in the first 3 months of the year. This comes as buyers pursued cross-county affordability amid the worst supply levels in decades, along with some of the highest city prices. This has sparked significant price competition in cheaper counties such as Longford, where buyers are prepared to move from Dublin for hybrid working opportunities in homes selling at an average of 180,700, a rise of 7,700 in just 12 weeks. But in Donegal, this is the average price of a three-bed semi-detached, which I'm not really sure if there's that many really that this is the model that they use anyway. But somewhat surprisingly, well, is it surprising? I don't know. Donegal is the cheapest in the country to buy a three-bed semi, $162,500. That's up 1.6%. Now, I would imagine there's not a great deal of property changing hands in Donegal. We know there is a shortage of rental property. There's also a shortage of available houses for sale or for people who need to move into moving into them. But that doesn't at this point seem to indicate a massive surge in property prices. I mean, Leitrim, which is quite a rural county, the average three bed there is, where is it? I saw it a little earlier on, 185,000, but in Donegal, 162,000. That's a 23,000 difference. That being said, I wonder how many houses in Donegal they're judging those figures off. It's just something that might interest me. You might remember a few weeks ago we talked about the gym in the Dáil and how very, very few sessions have been very few sessions have been booked in the Dáil gym. But there are sessions ongoing because thirsty TDs and senators took full advantage of Leinster House's cut price booze prices last year, as new figures reveal more than 10,000 pints of Guinness were knocked back in the Dáil's two bars. A total of 10,031 pints of plain were supped in the House of the Oireachtas, two licensed premises in 2023. And Guinness emerged as the biggest seller among politicians and Leinster House staff. And with a pint of the black stuff at Leinster House costing just £5.20, which is, how much is a pint of Guinness in Donegal? Well, anyway, a fraction of the price in nearby city centre bars, it's clear our elected reps are getting more bang for their buck than the average punter. The next most popular draft beer purchased was Heineken, 1,869 pints guzzled, while Cork Dry Gin was the spirit of choice with 1,620 measures sold. Wine was another big seller with their own brand Oireachtas at $6.40 a glass, proving to be the favourite, selling 4,102 units between January 1st, 23 and December 31st, 2023. Almost €360,000 was put across the bar last year, according to figures obtained under the Freedom of Information Act. On to now the Irish Mirror. And Europe should be concerned about the threat of Islamic State following the Moscow terror attack, the British Chancellor warned yesterday. The atrocity had echoes of the 2015 Bataclan concert hall attack in Paris when 130 people were killed by IS. Jeremy Hunt described the loss of civilian life on Friday night as a tragedy after 137 were shot and bombed. Asked whether European nations should be concerned by the threat of IS, Mr. Hunt said absolutely. He praised intelligence for foiling terrorist threats in recent years, but added, we have to remain vigilant. If it is Islamic State, I beg your pardon, they're prepared to murder in the most horrific ways. And sadly, these attacks, especially given the role of certain European countries in these world events, and I suppose it's something too we need to keep an eye on, given our stance on certain things, it's an inevitability that Belgium, France, Germany, Britain, and who's to say, God forbid, Dublin, God forbid anywhere, but you know what I mean, that they are likely targets, as I say, given the stance on certain things. In the Star this morning, a transgender darts player who beat top Irish ladies champ Katie Sheldon in a PDC Women's Series final over the weekend has revealed how she has been the target of online abuse. Dutch player Noah Lynn van Leuven won the Women's Series 2 event with a 5-2 victory over Dubliner Sheldon on Saturday. The victory came just a week after van Leuven also picked up a win on the men's PDC Challenge Tour. However, van Leuven, who's 28, who transitioned into a woman at age 17, says she often gets negative comments online, with some fans suggesting she should not be allowed to play in the women's event. She said, I just want to do my thing, but it seems like people have to comment. They often don't even read what is written. They immediately have reflex. Well, it's actually at the point now, the PDC have a very active Twitter account where they track results and what have you. And there's a lot of interaction on it. But if they post anything to do with Noah Lynn, they actually turn comments off on X. I've actually noticed that. But she's won in the women's, and last week she won in the men's. Right. Lastly, in the Irish Sun, just a note on the latest opinion polls released over the weekend. I don't write this. This is just the way it's written. A poll shows Sinn Féin has lost support and independents have risen past Fianna Fáil among political parties. Independent candidates surged by 3 points to 17% of would-be first preference votes in the SBP Red Sea poll, ahead of Fianna Fáil on 16%. But after previous highs, Sinn Féin, led by Mary Lou MacDonald, has fallen 3 points to 25%, their joint lowest score since the start of the pandemic. Fine Gael fell by 1% to 19. So you add Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael, and they are well ahead of Sinn Féin at this stage. Also, their joint lowest score since early 2020. Aintu, and I was wondering last week how Aintu might fare in the next opinion poll, and they fared quite well. They rose 2 points to 5, so that's a significant increase in support, what about 40%? While the Greens are up 1 to 4, the Social Democrats polled 6%, Labour 3, People 4, Profit, Solidarity 3. The study was made before Mr. Varadkar announced his resignation last week. So we'll watch again for the latest as it is released. Right, that was a run through some of the headlines in the papers today. Let's take a break. We'll be back with our first item on this show very shortly.
Daily newspapers are courtesy of Kelly Centra and Diner, Mountaintop Letterkenny, winner of Best Family Dining at the Highland Radio Hospitality Awards.
Get ready to hit the links with McGurk's Golf Letterkenny. Explore a range of clubs and clothing from TaylorMade, Callaway, Under Armour, J. Lindbergh and more, as well as TrackMan Custom Fitting. Special offer, mention Highland at checkout and receive 10% off when you spend €75 or more. Offer ends the 1st of April. T's and C's apply.
I hear you some wiring needs a fixing, ma'am. The name's Buzz, on account of my work.
No chance.
Not all cowboys ride horses. All Safe Electric registered electrical contractors must give you a certificate of completion that shows their work meets approved standards. Find one nearby on safeelectric.ie.
Are you an absolutely huge fonter or a Zoom inner? Perhaps you're an arm stretched out like a zombie when holding a newspaper or a squint so tightly at the menu the waiter thinks you're sleeping. Or at Specsavers, we get it. You don't want to admit it's probably time to become a glasses wearer. Or that's okay. We're ready to see you whenever you're ready to see properly. Book an eye test at specsavers.ie so you can see clearer. Okay, we'll stop with the errors now.
Mega Value Fun Fair this Easter. All rides only £2.50, excluding Stealth Bomber and Dodgems at Ebrington Square, Derry, Londonderry. From Friday, March 29th to Sunday, April 7th. From 2 p.m. until late every day. Treat the family to a great day out this Easter with Cullen's Mega Value Fun Fair at Ebrington Square, Derry, Londonderry.
Hi folks, Paul McDevitt here, inviting you to join myself and Jimmy Stafford this Monday night for another edition of the Monday Night Sessions. With his latest album released on Friday, we welcome back one of Ireland's top vocalists, the brilliant Davy Fury. And from Clonmany, making their Monday Night Sessions debut, we welcome the Two Bucks. We'll also be playing some of the latest releases from around the Northwest and the rest of the country. So that's the Monday Night Sessions, this Monday night, between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. right here on Highland Radio.
Now, we're going back to the story that we covered in quite some detail in the earlier part of this year. You might remember the news that physio services were being moved from St. Joseph's Hospital to two other locations, and there was concerns expressed by GPs and others that this would interfere with moving people to St. Joseph's for step-down care, whatever it might be. There was a meeting between concerned committee members and the community and the HSC earlier in March, and the committee met at the weekend also to see where things are at. I'm going to say good morning first, if that's okay, to Father Lorcan Sharkey, who's vice chair of the Save Our St. Joseph's Hospital Committee. Good morning to you, Father Sharkey.
Good morning to you, Greg.
Good to speak to you. Right. So can we go back maybe to the mid-March meeting maybe talk to us a little bit about that and what you were told, what assurances you received, if any?
Yes, Greg. We had our meeting with the HSE on Wednesday, the 13th of March. And we concluded at the end that as a committee, we felt it was a very positive and affirmative meeting. There were five representatives from HSE there, with particularly Frank Morrison, who is head of services for older persons, leading the HSE team. And on our side, then we had Patrick McGowan, Councillor Patrick McGowan, and three others. And then we were very delighted to see him coming as one of our local GPs, Dr. Dennis McCauley. He joined us as well. So we had a very positive and affirmative meeting. And I recall particularly that Frank Morrison, when we began the meeting after we had introduced ourselves, his opening question to us was very interesting, is what are your main concerns coming to this meeting today? So they were open to listening to us. And I told them on behalf of our group that we had already submitted from a previous meeting to them a list of questions that we wanted to have clarified. And he said, our response to you today is based on those questions. So that's how we were very positive.
Now, there was a drip of information in relation to initially, I won't go through the entire timeline, but initially the HSC said that these physiotherapy and occupational therapy services would have to be removed from the hospital because of upgrading works due to a HICRA report. They'd be provided in Donegal Town and to Lifford. Then we heard Dr. Dennis McCauley say that, well, this is incredibly concerning because unless they are actually on site, to refer people there or for them to move to the hospital there to continue their treatment would be problematic. Then the HSC released a statement saying that some of those services would be provided on the ward, and it all became a little bit confusing for me looking from the outside on to sort of track all what was going on. So can you clear up any of that for us as to what the current situation is?
Yes, of course. First of all, the physio had to be moved to Donegal and to Lifford, but that is a temporary measure because due to a HICRA report in January 24, there was a red alert raised about the fire regulations in the hospital throughout. And so when parts of the hospital were being renovated, the patients in that part of the hospital hospital would have to be relocated. And one of the wards that was taken over years ago for physiotherapy was what is known as the Drogheda ward, or Drogheda ward. And that is where the physiotherapy had been located, and that now had to be taken over. So for that reason, the physio had to be removed temporarily to both Donegal Town Hospital and to Lifford Hospital. And Dr. McCauley then raised the issue of the quality of the physio that would be available, and would it continue to be available, particularly to step down patients coming from Letterkenny Hospital. And he was assured that it would be to an adequately high standard. And I believe that at the end of that meeting, that Dr. McCauley was happy with that clarification.
Okay, because what was that? Because there's about 100 referrals to the hospital a week on average, and it just wasn't clear from the initial press releases. I think it took about the fourth or fifth press release where that was clarified. But so also to in successive press releases, the HSE said that they wanted to relocate these services to a suitable location in the Finn Valley area. Was there any clarification on that? Are they looking for a different premises, or when they talk like that, are they talking about returning them to St. Joseph's?
Well, because of the nature of physiotherapy, they need a lot of space because of the equipment that they have, so they need quite a large room for that. And it's quite possible that physiotherapy may return to a part of the hospital. It's been looked at the moment as a suitable, but not all the services will return to the campus of St. Joseph's, but they will be relocated quite close by so that people will have less and less travelling to do.
Was there any,
happy about that.
I beg your pardon, Father, was there any reference to other services that have been lost? Because a lot of people felt that this was like the death by a thousand cuts, you know, podiatry, chiropractic, dental in particular has concerned people.
Yes.
Any? Did the HSE talk of those services at all?
Oh, indeed, indeed they did, because we clarified that with them. Those services will also be returning, not just physio, but to the other services as well, such as podiatry and chiropody and so on like that. These things will be coming back in dental as well. They're looking at the moment at different premises in the area. Finn Valley area is a big area, I suppose, but we're hoping that they will be as close to Ballybuffet, Stranorer area as possible.
Now, the name of the group of which you're vice chair is Save Our St. Joseph's Hospital. Satisfied that the future of St. Joseph's is secured, and that it's not, we're not seeing a chipping away because of course, as you move things off campus, right, then what does St. Joseph's actually become into the future going forward? So are you clear as much as you can be with the assurances that you've been given, the HSE commitment to this facility and how it survives going forward if there's a centre of excellence or some other building providing a lot of these services in the vicinity?
Yeah, we're happy about that. Frank Morrison, who chaired the meeting on behalf of the HSE, assured us that the aim of HSE is to keep the hospital as busy as it is at present. Now, about 5 or 6 years ago, there were 68 beds in the hospital. But because of HICWA requirements, the number of beds had to be reduced due to the privacy of patients and so on and that. So the number of beds in each ward had gradually been reduced, so that at present, as we stand at the moment, there are 63 beds occupied in the hospital. And the aim of HSE is to continue with a minimum of 60 and maybe even 63 when everything, all the renovations are completed. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, if a ward is being renovated, people, residents in that ward have to be moved somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And then when that ward has been renovated, they will move back in again. So the vacant ward that was there for them was the Drogheda ward, where physiotherapy used to be located. But at the end, when all of the renovations are completed and a time scale of maybe 6 to 9 months, the St. Joseph's Hospital will be a hospital with 4 wards rather than 3 wards mm-hmm. as at present. And there will be adequate privacy for all the residents. So the idea of HSE is at the moment, and they assured us about this, is to keep the hospital as busy as it is at mm-hmm. present. So we're very assured about that.
Okay.
With all the other services coming back to the general area.
If not
to the campus.
On site, yeah, I get you. But what I don't know if we ever learn any lessons in this country. I'm not sure if all of this has been decided after the public furore or it was always on the cards. But we could have saved an awful lot of stress and anxiety here, the HSE could have, by releasing a properly worded statement talking of the future, talking a little bit of timelines, talking of dental, chiropody, podiatry, committing to the future of keeping this a busy facility. This could have been, right from the get-go, a really positive news story. But instead, people have been, you know, you had to leave your house and others had to leave your house to attend these meetings and all that for clarification. It just, we don't seem to learn any lessons That's about correct. Communications in this country. Such unnecessary anxiety. Okay.
Absolutely. And in fact, in that sphere, Greg, it must be noted as well that when our committee has been in existence for 6 or 7 years now, long before COVID came along, and we used to meet regularly, when particularly we heard a statement read into the Dáil record that the future plan of HSE was to close St. Joseph's Hospital. And that is still the Dáil record.
Mm-hmm.
And we have requested that be corrected. And we were told by the members of HSE who were there that the only people who could do that is one of our local TDs to ask the question in Dáil Éireann of the Minister for Health, what is the present plan of the HSE for St. Joseph's?
Mm-hmm.
And that then will be an opportunity for the Minister for Health, whoever it will be at that present time, to clarify and tell us all the exact situation. And, of course, you're correct about the information on coming out in bits and pieces and so on like that. And we did impress that on HSE members who were there at the meeting with us on Wednesday the 13th, that we would need to be better communicating with each other.
Yeah.
And they promised that they would keep in touch with us regularly from now on.
Because I think there was, we were harassing their email, I'm not going to lie to you, but I think there was 6 emails and it got slightly longer with slightly more information every time. And even a spokesperson, if they had come on, we could have cleared all of this up much more quickly. Father Lorcan, I'm sure you're busy this morning, so I'm going to say goodbye. Thank you very much for joining us and for giving us that update. And it's nice that it seems somewhat positive.
Thank you very much. Bye. It's very positive and very affirmative. Thank you very much, Greg.
Okay.
Bye-bye now. Thank
bye
you.
Bye-bye. Father Lorcan Sharkey, Vice Chair of the Save Our St. Joseph's Hospital Committee. You heard Fianna Fáil Councillor Patrick McGowan referenced in the course of that conversation, and he is with us also on the programme now. Obviously, Father, just to make sure you're on mute, Patrick, obviously, Father Sharkey is, has been very detailed in the information there. But if he's seeing this as a positive, that's almost good enough for me, I think.
Yeah, look, and I'd also just like to thank Jonathan Kelly and Margaret Hines. Margaret took the minutes, which is not an easy challenge sometimes, and we actually got them agreed with the HSE before we went out. We wanted to get the confusion out of it, and as you say too, the main thing to come out of this, we've agreed a communication strategy. They're going to stay in regular contact with our chairperson, who is now John Gallagher. Father John Joe is no longer the chairperson, but he remains committed to the committee, and something the committee is very grateful, because Father John Joe had done a lot of work behind the scenes before we went and met them, and also to thank Charlie McConnell for setting up that meeting and the HSE for meeting us. But also the important people here are the committee and their friends and neighbours and the patients of the hospital. So, look, I would concur, and we all concurred, that it was a good, positive meeting. It's regrettable. It's taken years of rumours and indecisions, and obviously what happened a couple of weeks ago come like a bombshell. But Very important what Father Sharkey said there. Like we are on a positive note now, and we're going to keep in regular contact with the HSE.
Yeah, and I think it's very important too that they are kept to their timelines as well, kept to these commitments.
Yeah, there's a lot on this. We covered a lot, and it's great to have Dr. McCauley there. He dropped. He agreed. He had been in UK the day before. He had come back. He changed his schedule. So we're very grateful because he was able to get into the real technical stuff. He was talking about protocols and what protocol they're acting under. The rest of us were kind of more general in our knowledge of the hospital and the different services. And we all know what we have lost. So we did get an explanation. We've got approximate time frames. They are for the daycare services, which have been lost in a lot of hospitals during COVID. They're going to be relocated temporarily, or they're going to be a place found them temporarily in the Fin Valley area. And then, as I say, one of the people there is Kathleen O'Dwyer. She's a property manager for Donegal, and she has said she has identified, in her opinion, a suitable location within St. Joseph's. There's a building there that's not been used, and we would see either the daycare service come back there or the physio with other services. So look, there's a lot of work to be done. They have explained to us, as Father Sharkey said, that there was an inspection done by HICWA in January, and that's just turned the whole thing upside down because all of the wards needs a new fire cert and that.
But look, I think what people want to be sure of is that, you know, these HICWA reports aren't really being used as an opportunity to, you know, reduce services, close things down and what have you. And that's why I think it's so important the HSC could have used this opportunity to reassure people of that. They must know. They've got a communications department that is incredibly well-staffed and incredibly well-resourced. And they should start sort of doing some of that stuff instead of firefighting. Yeah. Work, in fact, work with the media and councillors. If there's good news, get it out there.
Yeah. You know, I think too, we did ask them, look what we said to them, communicate with us. We're not trying to undermine the health forum that's there with the councillors and all the people. We're not looking to undermine or get information for the Dáil or anything else. We just simply want to know. And like, people were very, very worried because that rumour is still there about St. Joseph's Potent. Watch it as not. And I have undertaken now to try and get an answer, put the Minister and the Dáil, the Minister of Health, just to clarify, you know, that particular thing. But look, as Father Sharkey says, we left that meeting, all of us, on a positive note, but we won't be taking nothing for granted. We ain't going away. No. Simple as
okay.
that.
And I would love to be of the nature to be able to take the HSC at its word, but unfortunately, I'm not of that nature, so we'll have to keep a very close eye on this as well from our side of things. For now, Councillor Patrick McGowan, thank you very much for joining us. Have a good day.
And you too.
Appreciate it. All right, bye-bye. 086 60 25,000. If you want to get involved in that conversation, give us a call on 0749 125,000. Text or WhatsApp to 086 60 25,000.
Watch the show live now on YouTube, Facebook and at highlandradio.com.
Have you entered our 10,000 euro home makeover draw? If the answer is yes, then you are now automatically entered into our extra cash giveaway. If the answer is no, then now is the time to enter. Greg Hughes will be ringing one lucky person on Thursday the 28th of March and again on Friday the 5th of April, giving you the chance to win twice. That's not all. You will still have the chance of winning in our main draw of a 10,000 euro home makeover in association with Foy & Company, plus 5,000 euro in cash. Go to highlandradio.com now. Click on Win a Home Makeover, answer a simple question, and purchase your ticket. Imagine the possibilities.
Are you ready for massive savings with AEG at Irwin Expert Electrical? Purchase from now until the 14th of April and claim your cash back at aeg-offers.com. Experience top-notch appliances and enjoy the added perk of cashback delivered straight to your account within 28 days of approval. Elevate your home with AEG excellence and savings today. Don't miss out. AEG cashback at Irwin Expert Electrical, Letterkenny and Buncrana.
Kia is now making it easier to go green, offering 0% finance on the all-new Kia Niro. With an impressive 460-kilometre range on a single charge, the Niro ensures you can go the distance without compromise. Visit imotors.ie today and avail of this limited offer.
If you've lost someone close and it would help to talk, why not call the Bereavement Support Line on 1800 807 0077, Monday to Friday, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. We're here to listen. Managed by Irish Hospice Foundation and supported by the HSE.
The Deal Debate returns this Monday to look back at all the big G news stories of the week. In league action this weekend, Donegal's senior men's and ladies footballers and our senior hurlers. I'll be joined by Derry legend Paddy Bradley and two former county stars of hurling and football, Niall Cleary and Moyne O'Donnell. That's the Deal Debate this Monday just after 7pm news and podcasted on HighlandRadio.com.
The Deal Debate with Sister Sarah's Letterkenny. Serving food you'll love till 9pm daily in Sarah's Kitchen.
Okay, we go west now to Letterkenny. Cathal McGlynn is chair of the Ballymacool Residents Association. Cathal, good morning to you.
Good morning, Greg. How are you getting on?
I'm doing all right. Now, the association has been contacted by a number of residents. And tell us the background to this story for those who aren't aware.
Yeah, Greg. So last year, around September time, 20 families in the estate in Ballymacool received eviction notices from the landlord out there, Twin Estates, asking them to vacate their homes so that the houses could be sold. Now, there's a lot of work has gone on since that happened. I suppose, you know, we've been in the media quite a bit on with yourselves on Highland Radio and in some of the local papers and that. And we've been working closely with the County Council and with the Housing Authority and different organisations to try our best to try and keep these families in their homes. We had eight of the families that were deemed eligible for, you know, there's two schemes basically that are available for families if they're facing homelessness that they can avail of. And one of them is the tenant in situ scheme, which basically means that if a family is deemed eligible to get on the council housing list, then the council can then purchase that property and keep the family in their home. Also, the other scheme is the cost rental tenant in situ scheme, and basically with that scheme, if they're not eligible to meet the housing list or the council housing list, then the houses can then be purchased by the housing authority, and the families can be kept in their home. So we had eight families were eligible for the tenant in situ scheme and six families that were eligible for the cost rental tenant in situ scheme. So basically, you know, we thought that there was some light at the end of the tunnel and that things were moving forward well. You know, families were hopeful that through these schemes that they weren't going to have to vacate their homes and they'd be able to stay in the area where they live and work and have lived and worked for a number of years.
So what do you believe is going on here? Because, you know, the council's talking of process and due diligence and what have you, you know, but what does that mean to these families?
So last week, the landlord, Twin Estates again, sent out an email, to eight of the families that are eligible for the tenant in situ scheme, that they now had to vacate their homes by the 12th of April. They were saying that they had no correspondence back from the council and that they needed to go ahead with the sale of the homes. Mm-hmm. So we're like nearly 3 weeks away from that now, and we're back nearly to square one where the families are now being told again that they have to vacate their homes. We had correspondence with the council then. Councillor Jimmy Kavanagh raised it at the housing meeting last Thursday, and the council have stated that they are committed to buying these homes, but due diligence has to be followed. So basically, you know, according to the council, they have to follow certain process procedures before they can purchase the homes. One of them being the structural engineers' reports, which the structural engineers were in at the end of January and checked out all the houses. So they were still waiting for reports back from the structural engineers to say whether the houses are sound before the council can go ahead and buy them. Also, what we believe is, you know, the department would have to release the funds or make the funds available again for the council to purchase these houses. So, we were pleading and asking Twin Estates to hold back.
But for how long, though?
The evictions.
The council. Is it not that, you know, maybe the council could formally express an interest? I mean, obviously, this is private property, and you know, people are entitled to do, thankfully, in 2024 with their property what they wish. Or that being said, that might sound a little bit insensitive. I don't mean it to be like that. But my question is like, can the council not expedite this or speed it up, or at least say, right, we've done our diligence. Now we're just waiting for the money to come down from government. That might be enough. And we'll speak to the owner of these properties in a moment. That might be enough to say, right, well, that's a solid enough commitment for me to move forward in what other business endeavours I might have.
Yes, Greg, ideally that would be the case. Now, I mean, there is legislation in place that you cannot evict any more than 10 families in one area at the one time, you know, so that legislation is in place there. And I think this is like a divide and conquer exercise as well. But we would be asking the council and urging the council to try and speed this process up as quick as possible. I mean, obviously, you know, the bureaucracy can hold things back, and it can be sitting on somebody's table waiting to be signed off. But, you know, in an ideal world, we would really, really like to get this sped up and get the process sorted, you know, so that both the landlord and the families are happy with the outcome. But in the meantime, the council have stated that they will not be able to meet the deadline that Twin Estates has demanded. But we are pleading, and, you know, I mean, these are families. Where are they supposed to go? We're in the middle of a housing crisis. There are no homes there. Presently, we checked last week, there are three houses locally available for rent on daft.ie with extortionate rents that families cannot afford. So that's where we're left sitting. Mm-hmm. Where do these families go? There's nowhere for them to go to. They're going to be put out on the streets, and that is the truth about it. So then we also had another situation which came about on Friday evening, which came as a shock to all the residents on the estate, where they received the six families that were waiting for, or that were deemed eligible for the cost rental tenants in situ scheme with the housing authority, received emails at 4:30 on Friday to tell them that the housing authority were now not proceeding or not progressing with the purchase of those houses. So now those families, the rug has pulled completely from under their feet. They're devastated. These families are just, they're absolutely devastated. I've had them on the phone to me the last few days, some of the mothers in the houses in tears, you know, not knowing where they're going to go or what they're going to do or what we can do next. Okay. So, I mean, we're back to a stage now where I think we're even worse than we were at the start, right, at the beginning. Cattle, we're being left with absolutely no hope whatsoever.
I get you. I want to leave enough time for me to hear from Phil Boyle from Twin Estates, the owner of these properties. Phil, thanks for speaking to us. I really do appreciate it.
Good morning, Greg. How are you? Good morning, Cahill.
Good morning, Phil. How are you?
Right, okay. So, Phil, just, I mean, you've heard Cahill outline pretty fairly to what he sees as the situation, Phil. These are your houses. This is a business of yours, I presume. When did you decide you wanted to sell them, and what has the engagement been with the council like since?
We decided to sell these houses back in September. We don't have to get into the reasons of that. It was a business decision, and that is just the nature of business, unfortunately. It wasn't a decision that was taken lightly. It was a decision that was taken above my head in London, and so we decided that we would go with it, and I would have then sent out notices of terminations to all the families affected. At that time, though, I was speaking off the record to the county council, to the housing agencies, to see if there were any of these houses that these people would be interested in buying on their behalf. Because being the landlord there for the past 4 years, I know that certain tenants of mine would be on the housing assistance program. So I knew that the people on the housing assistance program would be eligible for council houses. So I've been working tirelessly, Greg, with all the tenants in affected by this since October, speaking to the housing agency, speaking to the county councils, and trying to get them to come in to sort this issue out. The cost rental tenant in situ scheme, Greg, is a new scheme that started last March 2023, and that was put in place by the government to allow for tenants that were facing eviction. It was allowing the government to come in certain situations and buy those houses if they fell within certain means. I spoke to the housing authority. They said there was a closing date by the 31st of December last year. I worked tirelessly with six of the residents to get them over the line. We managed to get everything over the line before Christmas last year. I spoke to the housing authority on numerous occasions. They were very open, very professional, and they said, look, everything looks good. We're sending engineers out now in January to look at them. And then after the engineers' reports come back, we believe then what happens then is the bidding process. So I was all excited. I was talking to the tenants. I said, look, guys, do not panic. I'm speaking to these people every week. On the other side, I had another eight of my tenants that were in receipt of the housing assistance program. So I contacted the county council themselves regarding this. This is a situation that under a housing assistance program, the county council can bid for the houses. They can buy the houses, and then the tenant becomes the county council becomes the landlord then in that case. Whereas with the cost rental tenant institute, the housing agency becomes the landlord. They then sell to a local housing body, and they become the landlord of those six tenants. Now, my problem is I really want a win-win situation here. It's very, very stressful for everybody involved, and I understand that completely. I would ask you to ask any of the tenants up there, any one of them that I haven't met, that I haven't sat down with, that I haven't tried to deal with this kind of on a one-to-one basis in my offices. Yes, they are in, you know, I've had these tenants in my offices crying. I've been saying, look, good lads, do not worry. We will get over this line. Now, my main problem is with the Donegal County Council. And unfortunately, instead of Cathal McGlynn being on the radio here, Cathal, and no offence to you, and I respect you and respect everything that you're saying there, it should be a county council people that are on here. I have been banging my head for 6 months trying to get conversations with the county council. They won't engage with me. They send engineers out without telling me. Sending engineers out. There is such poor communication.
It was stated that the area manager was in communication with you in the last couple of weeks. Did that happen or?
That happened after I emailed county councillors to say, what is happening here? I have to impress on these councillors. Look at folks, these people have been notices. You know, they were given notices in October. That's almost 5 months ago. You know, I need to impress on them the urgency of the situation. You know, the real world works quickly, but unfortunately, the public sector does not work that same way. I mean, I am waiting. I'm in a situation now that I'm waiting for the county council to come back to me and tell me exactly what type of testing is required for each of these houses before that they will even consider buying the house.
So just to waiting for fast forward things a little, Phil, is there anything that the council can say to you other than confirm a purchase or progress between now and April the 12th that will defer, that will make Twin Estates revise that April 12th eviction date?
First of all, Cahill is wrong in terms of what I emailed the tenants there a couple of weeks ago. When I emailed the tenants a couple of weeks ago, I said, look, it, guys, it's coming close to your termination times. What I would like you to do, guys, is I need you to pick up the phone. I need you to talk to your local councillors, and I need you to impress on them the urgency of this situation. That is what I emailed to them. Get on to it. Start banging on doors, because it doesn't seem to be working on my side. I mean, 10 emails I sent out, I got two responses. I mean, we're in a situation here that we're going to local government elections. Not one of these people have come back to me, bar two, you know, over the past 6 months. It's absolutely ridiculous. You know, I feel for these people. The housing crisis, the micro crisis, it is an absolute disaster for them. And I want to do my best.
Is there an eviction day of April 12th at this point?
There is an eviction day of April 12th at this point. Now, what I have suggested to the tenants, from a legal point of view, I cannot put down anything in writing to say that, you know, I'm extending that. But from what I would ask the tenants to do, don't panic. Nobody's going to be kicked out on the 12th of April. What I want you to do is, it's considered as overholding. But I'm not putting that on record, because if I put that on record or on down in paper, pretty much telling them that, you know, that the contract or the notice of terminations are null and void. You know, I'm under pressure to sell these houses, as is my right as a private company to sell these houses. But I would ask the county council to come on here, Greg, and explain to you why it is such a broken system there.
Okay, well, we'll make those inquiries. Cahill, you heard from Phil there. Is there, do you sympathise with his frustration in trying to deal with the council on this issue?
Well, I think that initially, you know, this mess has been caused by Twin Estates deciding to evict the families in the first place, you know, and I don't believe that they have the best interests of those families at heart.
Do you believe, though, Cahill, that a private company is entitled to sell the properties, and they've given the council the option of buying them? I mean, we can't. Yes, and these are only questions, Can I finish the question? Can we expect the private sector to be doing the work of, you know, the council and the housing bodies?
Well, we would like everybody to step up to the mark, and nobody wants to see anybody evicted. We all want to see those families kept in their homes, you know, and obviously we've been working closely with some of the councillors, with Micheál Colum McGill-Asbug, with Councillor Jimmy Kavanagh and with Michael McBride, who have all been making representations on our behalfs and on behalfs of the residents there, you know, and
Unfortunately, Phil, come back in next. I only have about a minute. Do you want to come back? We would really like to see the council
speed this process up. I have stated that before. We'd like to see the council speed this process up. There are also families that are...
All right, Cahill, if you just hold a sec, I want to give Phil a chance to reply, because I do have to break for the 10 o'clock news. Go ahead, Phil.
Is for the council to actually put in writing that they're willing to buy these houses subject to these mica tests coming back, and that them being fine and good and within a certain, you know, percentage. We've had mica tests done and everything is fine up in Ballymacool, and I want them to come back and confirm to me in writing, yes, we will progress with this further if the mica results come back, you know, and everything is positively good.
That would give you space. You're saying, Phil, that would give you space with the company?
Absolutely, it would give me space with the company. Right, now, from the housing, I'm very, very disappointed that they would even email people before they would email me. And, like, they came back with a vague point that we're not progressing further with this. I emailed them back and I said, I'm sorry, but I've been working with you for 6 months and now you're saying not progressing. Please explain to me why you're not progressing.
Right, okay, listen, I have to leave it there. I'm sorry, Cathal, for cutting across you there towards the end. It's just to try and give everyone a crack of the whip. I do appreciate your time. Cathal McGlynn, Chair of the Ballymacool Residents Association, Phil Boyle of Twin Estates, and we, of course, will find out as much as we can from the council where their position is. Back after the news and obituary notices.
MEVA FRC is seeking to recruit a project administrator who will be responsible for controlling and monitoring the overall financial expenditure of the project and organise the administration of its service. The post will be 35 hours per week. For job description and application form, please email mfrcrecruitment@gmail.com. Shortlisting criteria will apply. Closing date for receipt of applications is Friday 29th of March at 12 noon. Applications will only be accepted on the official application form. CVs will not be accepted.
This Easter, come rain or sun, put a spring in their steps and seek out somewhere special as a family. From Easter trails for young explorers to a treasure trove of stories at historic places and room to roam in the fresh spring air. You'll find more than one great day out, on your doorstep or further away, with the National Trust this Easter. Search National Trust NI and start planning your family's adventure.
Did you know Tinney's Toys stock top toy brands like the Care Bears, VTech, Leapfrog, Lamaze, Playmobil, Tonka and much more? We also have a massive range of outdoor toys like swings, slides, swing ball, goalposts and rebounders. And don't forget, we're still Ireland's largest farm toy superstore. Open Monday to Saturday, Leck Road, Letterkenny, or online at tinneystoys.com.
Do you suffer from high cholesterol, menopause symptoms, digestive issues, anxiety, aches and pains, or a lack of energy? The highly trained team at The Natural Way Letterkenny can provide advice on natural remedies for a number of individual health issues. The Natural Way also has its own brand of herbal treatments to help fight fatigue, relieve digestive discomfort, maintain a healthy immune system, and alleviate common menopause symptoms. The Natural Way at Letterkenny Shopping Centre, your one-stop health shop.
Highland Radio weather updates with Ireland West Airport. You don't visit Liverpool for the weather, but it does rain gulls at Anfield. Fly to Liverpool daily with Ryanair. Ireland West Airport. Don't just take off, take it easy.
Live, on air, online and on the Highland Radio app. This is Highland Radio News.
Good morning, I'm Michaela Clark with the news at 10 o'clock. Speculation is now turning to who will make up the Fine Gael side of Cabinet after Simon Harris was elected as leader of the party yesterday. The Higher Education Minister ran unopposed, which meant he was installed as Leo Varadkar's replacement. Simon Harris says he will speak to current ministers to assess their positions and policy ahead of his election as Taoiseach when the Dáil returns from the Easter recess. Ireland editor with the Irish Independent, Finan Sheehan, says there is one vacancy already, with Leo Varadkar stepping down.
Peter Burke is seems to be the top of the list, the Junior Minister for European Affairs. The next one then is slightly more awkward. You basically go to each of the sitting ministers and say, are you running in the next general election? If the answer is no, then you're out. But nobody is indicating, and Coveney was actually saying yesterday he is running in the next general election. So Simon Harris is going to have to sack somebody if he's gone down that route.
The HSE has confirmed some physiotherapy services may return to St Joseph's Hospital Stranorlar. There were fears earlier this year that the HSE was attempting to reduce services at the community hospital as physiotherapy services were being withdrawn and relocated to Lifford and Donegal Town. It was part of a temporary measure in light of recommendations contained in a HICWA report to carry out fire safety improvement works. Father Lorcan Sharkey, Vice Chair of the Save Our St Joseph's Hospital Committee, told the 9 till noon show that assurances were given at a meeting over the weekend to return a number of services to the facility.
Those services will also be returning, not just physio, but to the other services as well, such as podiatry and chiropody and so on like that. These things will be coming back, in dental as well. They're looking at the moment at different premises in the area. Finn Valley area is a big area, I suppose, but we're hoping that they would be as close to Ballybuffet, Stranorlar area as possible.
The future of people living in de facto blocked social properties remains uncertain. Councillor Liam Blaney says some minor repair works were carried out at a number of years ago, but since then there has been a lack of communication with the inhabitants. He's urging Donegal County Council to step in while they await a scheme to remediate the social homes.
There has been some houses where the houses have been patched temporarily and carried over a while until the new scheme was announced, but unfortunately that new scheme hasn't been announced yet, and some of the houses that has been patched up is deteriorating at a very rapid rate, and even as far as whether water come back into them again. I've called the council to try and see if they can accommodate these people that are living in these conditions, that they either go out right away and try and remediate the house temporarily again or to move them into their properties. But look, we're waiting far too long on a social housing scheme to be announced, and long, long overdue, and I do hope that it's announced pretty shortly.
The future of the fisheries in the EU is centre stage at a meeting in Belgium today. An informal meeting of ministers is taking place, which will discuss ways to protect and boost the sector. Minister for the Marine, Charlie McConnough, welcomes the opportunity to discuss the future of the industry.
We need to make sure that right across the EU, and particularly from my point of view in Ireland, that we work to support our fishers, and that we work to support as well the fact that there will be strong fisheries into the future. Another key issue which I will be raising today, and which I raised continuously as well, is the ongoing impact of Brexit.
Donegal is the cheapest county for housing, while Dublin remains the most expensive place in Ireland to buy a house. The figures contained in the Irish Independent, or EA, Average House Price Index show the national average price of a three-bed semi-detached is around €308,000. Average prices in Donegal are €162,500, up 1.6% in the last 3 months. It's in stark contrast to an average asking price of over €517,000 in Dublin. There's calls for Donegal County Council to develop a town plan for Convoy. Councillor Patrick McGowan believes the growth of population in the town warrants a review of infrastructure. He says Convoy is acting as a satellite town for Letterkenny and the expansion of it must be plan-led. Councillor McGowan says a review of Convoy is vital.
Because of the amount of development that's even proposed there at the moment, there's an urgent need to have a town plan, to have some kind of a strategy about where the houses should go and what kind of services is there, and this is about creches, schools, about everything else.
With an eye mostly cloudy today, with outbreaks of rain and drizzle becoming lighter and patchier as the day goes on. Highest temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees. That's all from Highland Radio News for now. We'll be back with an update again at 11 o'clock. Until then, you can keep up to date with the latest local news on our website, highlandradio.com. Good morning. The obituary notice is for this Monday morning, March the 25th. The death has occurred of Jerry Sweeney, Glasgow and Rye. Remains reposing at his sister-in-law Lorraine Dugan's home in Clonbara, Falkara from 2 o'clock this afternoon and tomorrow from 12 noon, with rosary both nights at 9 o'clock. Funeral mass on Wednesday at 12 noon in St Finan's Church, Falkara, with burial in the adjoining cemetery. Family time after the rosary and on the morning of the funeral. Mass can be viewed live on mcnmedia.tv or on Sweeney Funeral Directors in Balmer's Facebook page. The death has occurred of William Stanley McComb, 1 Gort Mellon Road, Cullion. Funeral leaving his late home, 1 Gort Mellon Road, Cullion, tomorrow morning at 11:45 for a service of thanksgiving for his life in Dunamana Presbyterian Church at 12:30, with burial afterwards in Upper Cumber Cemetery. Family flowers only, please. Donations in lieu if desired to Derry Masonic Fund or Orange Widows Fund, care of Mrs. Ruth Hay, Funeral Director. The death has taken place of Eddie Doherty, Gulladuff, Moville. Eddie's remains are reposing at his home. Eddie's funeral mass will take place on Wednesday morning at 11 o'clock in St Mary's Church, Ballybrack, with burial afterwards in Ballybrack Graveyard. Family time from 11 o'clock to 11 o'clock. The death has taken place of Cahill McFadden, The Square, Milford. His remains are reposing at his brother Annis and Margaret McFadden's residence at Upper Mount Marion, Milford. Family time, please, from 10 o'clock until 12 noon. Funeral from there tomorrow morning, going to St Peter's Church, Milford, for 11 o'clock Requiem Mass, followed by interment in Milford Cemetery. The death has occurred of James O'Donnell, Dan, Belcritch, Kincashla. His remains will repose at McGlynn's funeral home today from 4 o'clock, with removal at 5:30, going to St Mary's Church, Kincashla for 6 o'clock, where he will repose overnight. Funeral mass tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, with interment after in Belcritch Cemetery. The death has taken place of Kay O'Kane, Nae McDermott, 2 Craigmore Drive, Clonie, County Derry, and formerly of Dunamana. Kay is reposing at her home. Family time, please, from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock. Funeral tomorrow afternoon, leaving her late home at 12:30 for 1 o'clock Requiem Mass in St Patrick's Church, Clonie. Interment immediately afterwards in the adjoining graveyard. Family flowers only, please. Donations, if desired, in lieu to Foyle Hospice or Marie Curie, care of McLaughlin Funeral Directors. The death has occurred of Vincent Sherry Spinogue Burt. Vincent's remains are reposing at his home. Removal from his home tomorrow morning at 10:30 to St Angus's Church, Burt, for Requiem Mass at 11 o'clock, followed by interment in Burt Cemetery. Requiem Mass can be viewed on churchservices.tv. Family time, please, from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock. Family flowers only, please. Donations in lieu to Letterkenny University Hospital, care of any family member. The death has occurred of John Ward, Mahara Han Rafo, formerly of Errisbeg, Roundstone, County Galway and London. John will be reposing at Kelly's funeral home today from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock, with rosary at 5 o'clock. Funeral from there tomorrow morning at 10:30, going to St Junan's Church Rafo for 11 o'clock Requiem Mass. Afterwards, the funeral cortege will travel to Our Lady, Star of the Sea Church, Roundstone, County Galway, to repose overnight. Funeral Mass will take place on Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock, with burial afterwards in Gurteen Cemetery, Roundstone, County Galway. The funeral mass of John can be viewed online via the Rafo Parish webcam. Family flowers only, please. The death has occurred of Donna Dorian, Monellan, Crossroads, Killigordon. Funeral leaving her home on Wednesday morning at 10:20 for Requiem Mass in St Patrick's Church, Crossroads, Killigordon at 11 o'clock. Interment afterwards in the adjoining churchyard. The Requiem Mass will be streamed live on the parish YouTube channel. The house is private, please. The death has occurred of Elizabeth Hannon, Tuberkeen, Dunloe. Funeral service this afternoon at 2 o'clock in St Crone's Church of Ireland, Dunloe, with burial afterwards in the adjoining graveyard. Family flowers only, donations in lieu to her parish church, care of Sean McGlynn, funeral director, or any family member. And the death has taken place of Cecilia Sheila McCarran, Nick Curran, formerly of Nixon's Corner and Killay Derry. Funeral cortege will leave Kelly's funeral home this morning at 10:10 for 11 o'clock Requiem Mass at the Church of the Immaculate Conception, Killay, with burial immediately afterwards in All Saints Church Cemetery, Newton Cunningham. Mass can be viewed on newtonkillayparish.ie. Family flowers only, please, with donations in lieu if desired to Melmount Manor Nursing Home patients and Comfort Fund, care of any family member or Kelly's funeral directors. For family information and more details regarding wakes and funerals, please go to highlandradio.com.
Sheridan Security, now introducing Zero Wire smart alarm systems. Zero wire, zero mess, and a real peace of mind. With a simple press of a button, your alarm can be set or unset, or download the free app and control it from your phone. Call us today on 074 912 6025 and get your alarm from €299. Stay local, stay safe, and protect what you value most with Sheridan Security Systems.
It's hilarious. It's Matches and Old Flames by Tommy Maron, coming to On Grain on Theatre Letterkenny this Friday and Saturday night.
It's time we unlocked your handcuffs and let both of you loose.
I am not handcuffed.
Neither am I.
You can have mine if you want them.
Don't miss Matches and Old Flames this Friday and Saturday night on Grain on Theatre Letterkenny. See ongrainon.com for details.
When it's time for confirmation or First Communion, it's time for a trip to Watson Menswear, Letterkenny. Choose from a great selection of top label, casual and formal wear. Suits with matching shirts and ties, blazers and jackets. Also denims, chinos and footwear from big names like Diesel, 1880 Club and Tommy Bow. Stand out on the big day at Watson Menswear. Open 7 days a week on Main Street, Letterkenny and watsonmenswear.com.
Tuesday, 2nd of April is World Autism Awareness Day, and we can't wait to celebrate it at Century Complex. We will be having a sensory screening of Kung Fu Panda 4 in Century Cinemas at 11 a.m. before the crowds. Century Play will also be sensory friendly from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. on the day to let the little ones explore.
Go all Aldi with 20 meals for under 20 euro. That's right, mighty meals every weeknight for a family of four for under 20 euro. How about spaghetti and meatballs Monday? Or Tuesday, sizzling vegetable stir fry. There's chicken steak, potato wedges and carrots, plus chicken oyster thighs, butternut squash mash and peas. And Friday's favourite, fish, rice and munch too, too. No vouchers, no apps, no messing. Follow the path to lower prices. Go all Aldi.
You're very welcome back to the 9 till noon show following the news at 10. Thanks to Michaela for that. And thank you for all of your comments coming in over the first hour. As it relates to the future of St. Joseph's Hospital, a caller says, I'm not convinced of the safety of St. Joseph's going forward. I'm not sure if you mean the safety sort of accessing services within it or its future. Greg, I'm not sure if I believe the HSE. I'd be very wary of their promises, as would I. And that's why we'll keep a close eye on that. They moved physio, which was located in the middle of Drogheda Ward, but kept staff changing wards and admin offices on either side. They stayed put. Thank you very much for that. Loads of comments as it relates to, they were carried over some of these as it relates to sort of the change really in Fine Gael leadership and Taoiseach and generally on politics. Is AIM2 the party that was formed after a certain TD didn't agree with the result of repeal referendum? So much for democracy, says a listener. Another, the government didn't care about the lack of services before refugees arrived. Why do you think they would care now? They couldn't care less. Another, how long will Simon Harris last as Taoiseach? The Minister for Health, who thought there were 18 COVID viruses before COVID-19, can't see him lasting too long. Is that why he thought it was 19? I actually missed that one. Simon Harris is weak. We don't want anyone who's weak. When he was low in government, he was very pro-life. As soon as he went up and everyone else supported abortion, he did too. If he had been pro-abortion all along, we wouldn't have minded, but he changed his mind. And that is what others were doing. We don't want someone who goes with the crowd. With Leo stepping down from the Dáil, am I not right in thinking under Irish law, constitution, that the government has to dissolve? No, unfortunately, I don't really care whether it dissolves or not. That is not the case. Greg Varadkar has the country destroyed with mass immigration, believes a listener. Good riddance to Leo Varadkar. Showed no sympathy towards Mica homeowners, a complete failure. How can young people come back here? Where would they live? That's the difference now. Simon Harris, the Minister of Higher Education, that is no higher education. A lot of people didn't like last week when it was pointed out that he didn't have higher education. Even those that might not be Harris supporters were like, well, that shouldn't be the case. Glad to see the back of Leo Varadkar. He destroyed the country with his liberal crusade. Never a person for the ordinary family. Joe McHugh is delusional, defending him, making pathetic excuses. He was obviously told to go on his arrival home. Call a general election now. It's what the people want up here in Donegal. We do not want the city slicker Harris or Donoghue. Enough is enough. Well, now it is Harris, and as I say, nothing about that whole process surprised me. As a carer and parent, it would be better to come up with a plan to prevent all the people, unfortunately, that assist their own death, which has risen out of control. Can you say the national debt owing collectively is 233 billion? Leo says he's taken the country from austerity to prosperity. The man has rocks on his head. We went from 206 billion to 233 billion relatively recently, and it's now 48,000 national debt per every man, woman and child in the country. I hear a lot of people say that we have full employment. Really, if all the young had to move away to get jobs to build their own homes, were still here, then numbers would be much different. That's complex, and complex as to the reason why. And also too because of wages and what have you and housing availability. Having a job simply nowadays does not mean that you can build your own home. Back in the day, you know, back in the 80s, 90s, even when interest rates were like 15%, you could see a pathway to owning your own or building your own property. I think the problem is a lot of people, even in full employment, don't see that pathway. Simon Harris, the National Children's Hospital, need we say more? Another, we need change in this country. People can't go on much longer. Another caller says, time for an election. Irish people have changed their minds. Irish Prime Minister Leo Varadkar resigned, saying, I'm not right for the job now. Fianna Fáil, Greens, Fine Gael, not right for the job now either, believes that listener. Another, I like Simon Harris for the job, but it should really be the decision of the public to choose who they want in charge. I can't believe how Highland is fawning over Leo. What did he ever do for Donegal? There should be a general election. Well, I certainly haven't been involved in any fawning. I've never fawned over a politician yet, so I'm not sure what part of our coverage you see is fawning. Why, another caller says, why is patting Leo on the back, having all these Fine Gaelers on blowing bubbles? Well, at the end of the day, everyone has a right to speak. Just because you disagree with in politics, and this is probably what problem we have in this country right now, if I disagree with a group of individuals or a group disagree with a person, I don't want them censored or not spoken to. I mean, I would imagine like it's quite possible that the person who says, why are you patting Leo on the back having all these Fine Gaelers on, is probably, might be a person who is opposed to the new hate speech laws, which is really some feel about censorship and controlling the narrative. I mean, you don't seriously would think that on one hand and then sort of suggest that we shouldn't hear from an established political party who's changed its leader on the other, I'm sure. Greg, I think you'll find that the media also make a big deal that Leo was gay and of Indian origin, so people will jump on that. But just talking about that doesn't mean he should be open to criticism for those two things, surely. As health minister, he wasn't much good, had a chance to improve, but lost the plot. That comes in from Mary. Just time for a couple more. Sinn Féin is desperate for an election now because they know that all the new independents and parties may not be fully organised or registered, not as well known. That is the main reason for their push. Thankfully, they showed their hand during the two referendums by siding with the government, and people realise they are not the answer to what the Irish people need. Okay, right, that's a catch-up on some of those. 086 60 25,000, WhatsApps and texts to that number, of course. Give us a call on 07491 25,000. The Easter egg has been found, by the way. Caroline, do you have that information about the egg? Did I take that or you're handing it to me? There's a competition running on the Naughty Alarm Clock show with Lee Gooch. The egg was at Sean McCool's Park. Well done. And I heard, we were talking about the new sign there on Friday, and I heard the sign is resplendent. Were you at it? What did you think? We're going to be talking GEA more generally with Brendan Devaney. And I've kept my powder dry in this one a wee bit in terms of the national coverage of the Donegal senior football team, the men's senior football team I'm talking about now, because I don't want to sort of come across as anti-RT or anti-this, that and the other all the time. But, like, what have you thought of the national coverage of Donegal this year? I mean, I don't watch the Sunday game, but I was speaking to people who have watched the Sunday game that watched it to see how Donegal got on certain games, not even highlights. Barely even a mention. There is also some suggestion that and this was talked about at the game on Saturday, that, you know, there are some RT presenters that don't even like talking about Donegal. So again, I know sometimes it might come across that we're moaners up here, but I think most of the time if we are moaning, there's justification to it. So I mean, obviously, you can understand certain games aren't going to be broadcast, right? Because maybe they're dead rubbers or, you know, there's a lot of games to be covered and so on and so forth. But do you think Donegal so far got a fair crack of the whip in terms of its coverage? Any of the games that were, well, not a lot of the games, but they were sort of online or were pay-per-view and others, there were no highlights from them at all. So as a football fan, and as I say, we can put this to Brendan a little later on. As a football fan, do you think there's a sort of an anti-Donegal sentiment with the national broadcaster? What do you think? let us know. I'm not trying to stir, but I can only try and reflect the conversations people are having out there. And a lot of people have said to me that they feel that Donegal's not getting a fair crack of the whip. Right, sorry, Sean McCool Park, that's where the egg was. Lena O'Reilly and Raymond Doherty found the egg. It's all part of this Easter week. It's the iMotors Easter Easter egg hunt. It's on Lee Gooch's naughty alarm clock. So there's a car going around the place. It's going to be somewhere else tomorrow. So tune in to Lee Gooch's show after 8 a.m. and you could be in with a chance to win that egg, but also of winning a €500 Ryanair voucher. Anyway, Lee Gooch will tell you more about that tomorrow. He's a good egg.
The county's number one talk show, the 9 till noon show on Highland Radio.
It's time for Vision Ireland Bingo on Highland Radio.
It's Monday the 25th of March. You're playing on the green sheet. The reference number is S1. It's game number 13. The numbers are 81, 55, 16, 65, 75, 12, 40, 60, 45, and finally 67. Phone your claim to 910-4833 before 8 tonight, leaving your name, contact number and the name of the shop where you purchased your book, and we'll call you back the next working day. Get all your Vision Ireland bingo information at highlandradio.com. There's bingo every Monday night at Halfway House Burnford. Doors open at 7:30 with eyes down at 8:30. €2,500 must go. The snowball is now €1,250, 145 numbers or less. If you're not in, you can't win. That's Halfway House Bingo tonight at 8:30.
Connect Hearing is open for free hearing tests. Our audiologist is available Monday to Friday for wax removal services at our Letterkenny Clinic in the Courtyard Shopping Centre. We also offer a home visit for those who aren't able to visit us. Our hearing is our social sense. Are you finding hearing more of a challenge? Call Ursula today on 07491 13296 to make an appointment. Good hearing helps us to connect to our family, friends and loved ones. Connect Hearing, connecting you to life.
Bluebird Care are currently recruiting carers and nurses across Donegal with immediate starts available in Letterkenny, Ballybuffet, Inishowen and Donegal Town areas. Your career with Bluebird Care starts here with new attractive pay rates, travel assistance, paid training courses and ongoing career progression opportunities. Why not contact Bluebird Care on 07491 29562 or learn more at bluebirdcarecareers.ie. Bluebird Care, more than just a career in care.
Now, you're very welcome back to the programme, and we're talking Relay for Life, and we've got two guests in studio to talk about this year's event. We have Seamus Devine, Chair of Relay for Life Donegal. Good morning, Seamus.
Morning, Greg. Thank you for having us.
And Magella O'Donnell, who is the patron of Relay for Life Donegal. Magella, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Greg. Thanks for having us.
Right, so Relay for Life is back. It's at the ATU in Letterkenny this year, the 25th of May 2024, Seamus.
Yeah, it's 25th and 26th. We're starting an hour earlier this year. We're starting at 4. Last year was 5, so we're running from 4 to 4. And we've an unbelievable uplift this year. Teams are absolutely flying. Thanks to your good selves, we're getting great coverage. We're probably up about 6 or 7 already on this team last year, so we're getting near capacity.
Can we talk like this is the first time it's ever happened, if you know what I mean? So, Relay for Life, it's down at the ATU. It's a beautiful, it's just a beautiful setting, and we were there last year, and it was just absolutely wonderful. So, the concept behind Relay for Life.
Relay for Life is it's a worldwide event. It originally in America, and the Irish Cancer Society. A Cancer Society event. The Irish Cancer Society have taken it on board. We've been running it since 2012 here in Donegal. It's basically a 24-hour event where everyone who has been affected in any way by cancer or who's an interest in research in cancer comes together for the weekend. The key focus on the weekend is about survivors and survivorship. The survivors are our heroes, shall we say, for the weekend. And Part of the reason we're here today is actually to talk about a survivor program. Mm-hmm. It opens with what we call the survivor's lap. It opens the first thing, and the survivors, they march around the pitch. They take us around the pitch and open the event for us. Now, there's a number of different events that happen during it, but the biggest part is that there's teams that take part in it. The word relay is used because they're passing it on from people are walking on the track for the full 24 hours. Unfortunately, a lot of people take the idea that it's running. It's not running. It's walking. If you want to run,
you get
you
a speeding ticket if you run. I think.
Well, if you want to run, we'll let you, but we might corral you onto a different track.
And I just like this is for all of the community, and the reason it's for all of the community is because one in two of us will get cancer, and every single one of us, unfortunately, will have someone in our lives with cancer.
Yeah.
So. And also, it is a beautiful thing to be a part of. There's lots of murmurs and chat and conversation. There's music, there's stalls, there's people on bikes doing spin-a-thons and different things like that there. So even if it's not specifically to attend for the reasons that you've outlined, the more people that go to it as a beautiful community event in and of itself, I think... It would be fantastic. And I think I just want the broader public to see that this is absolutely for everyone, and it is for all of us, because very sadly this horrendous disease affects all of us either directly or indirectly.
Yeah, that's 100% true, Greg. We try to make it a fun event. We try to make it lighthearted. Obviously, there are parts of it that are somber, one thing or another. But yeah, there's music on stage. We have an actually amazing candle ceremony at night where the music is toned down, and Maya Brennan is again going to be part with us again this year at it. But yeah, the people's faces. We have a team of superheroes who dress up as Superman and Batman, and we have Toy Story characters coming, and we have all sorts of events from milking cows to gathering potatoes. Mm-hmm. There's so much fun and activity at it.
Yeah. And there's loads of parking as well. I'll come back to you, Seamus, because we'll go through, we'll put a final call out there, not a final call, but a team for in relation to creating a team and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
But Magello O'Donnell, patron of Relay for Life, Donegal. I mean, frame this sort of whole couple of days for us, Magello, in your mind?
Well, firstly, may I say that I've just been promoted to patron. Daniel actually is the patron of Donegal Relay for Life, but now I am a co-patron. So we're in it together. It's a fantastic weekend. I mean, it's 2 days, really. And the fact that everybody comes together, there's a fantastic, positive, friendly atmosphere on the pitch. I didn't do it the first time. And last year was the first time that I actually took a stand. I had a team, if you like. So I did fundraising and everything. And the day, it was just fantastic because the pitch is full of people buzzing. And as you rightly said a second ago, all the activities and things for people to do. It's a real family event, and there's, you know, music, live music. You know, rumour has it that Daniel O'Donnell may even do, you know, a few songs.
This is coming from a very reliable source close to Mr. O'Donnell.
Well, I tell you what, it's not that reliable. Sometimes I don't know what he's doing. I'm sure he will. Yeah. So, you know, it's not just about coming and being somber and serious and discussing. It's a family event for everybody.
There's a togetherness to it, which this is the thing I'm trying to portray. Not that it needs me to try and portray, but I just think it's a very nice thing. It would be a very nice thing for all families to come together. Everybody sort of deals with this disease in a different way, right? Whether you've had it or you've lost someone to it. You can be angry at it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Or whatever it might be, and everyone comes to it at a different point. But it's not about that. This is about humanity as well, too.
Absolutely.
And us as a community, Magello.
Yep, it is, absolutely. And I know myself, some people, it's not for them.
Mm.
They feel like, oh, I have cancer, or I had cancer, and the last thing I want right now. But funnily enough, a year or two passes, and when that sort of the big trauma has eased off a bit, then they tend to come back and want to be part of it. It's just something, as you said, one in two people are going to have a cancer diagnosis in their lives. We should all, I believe, be out there supporting it. It's, you know, it respects no boundaries when it comes to people. We know, you know, King Charles, Princess Kate, both have cancer. It's just so prevalent in society at the moment. And the more people we can get to come out, and especially survivors, because they're the ones that show you how successful research is becoming. And when you see a field, for people that don't ever go there, there are different T-shirts, different groups and different colours. And the survivors, cancer survivors, wear purple T-shirts and it says, "I am a cancer survivor." And then the committee wear an orange T-shirt.
We've gone green.
Oh, gone green. They've gone green. Oh, well, that's good. Yeah. That's good. Good for the planet.
Yeah.
Anyway, but when you see a field full of purple T-shirts and you know, and you're walking around with everybody and you're saying, "God, I had cancer. God, look at that little girl.
Yeah.
She's only 10. She had cancer." Or, "Look at that woman over there." Or, "There's two sisters." Yeah. Or, you know, and it's a real camaraderie. It's a brilliant atmosphere altogether, a positive one.
Yeah, because, you know, if cancer didn't exist and then there was a worldwide announcement saying this disease has been foisted upon us and one in two of us will get it and it will affect children, and you know, we would react very, very differently.
Absolutely,
you know, I'm not
yeah.
saying we're complacent, I don't know, or accepting or whatever, but, you know, can you imagine if it was announced on us how we would
and that's what we're hoping for eventually,
That it's,
you
that,
know,
that
we, a cure,
and
for
we
it.
Are making great inroads in that, and these type of events do help in that regard too. You know, treatment is hugely important, but research
absolutely.
Is
absolutely. I wouldn't be here, Greg.
We do amazing
years
things
back.
In
I
terms
would not.
Of research here. And we were speaking last week or the week before to a lady who got cancer and then discovered she was pregnant. And the only way you can know what you can do in terms of cancer treatment during pregnancy is through, you know, previous experience and
exactly.
research.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And,
yeah.
Yeah. And she referenced that herself. Right. So in terms of the teams now. I don't sure if you can be oversubscribed, Seamus, but there are still you can still put a team together. So how does that work?
You can.
And I'm talking to people across the entire region here, not in a 10-mile radius of Letterkenny. We want people from, if you're in Bundoran listening, Ballyshannon, Lahey, Pettigoe, right across the coast.
Yeah.
This is for everybody. Yeah. It just happens to be in the centre of Donegal.
Yeah. It's not Letterkenny really. It's Donegal really, and that's something we'll be very, very keen to promote. Basically, a group of individuals come together. You're really looking to man the event for the weekend. You're probably looking at least 10 people involved. And the idea is that someone of your team will be available to be on the pitch at all stages throughout the 24 hours. What we're finding is that people do at a rota, people come for an hour and they stay for 6 hours because the atmosphere is incredible. The team is, as Majel said, the teams wear the white T-shirts. They do some activities at their tent. Every team has their own gazebo. They have their own space on the pitch, and it becomes a focal point. Some are making teas, some are making coffees, some make pizzas in the middle of the night, which is shouldn't be done, but it's amazing. but different things are happening. We have
I'm
had
to figure out why you shouldn't make pizzas in the middle.
I know,
but anyway, can we we'll forget about that?
Yeah, health and safety mightn't just allow that. But anyway, we get there.
It's a microwave. They microwave.
Well,
pizza, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Cold pizza,
I'll not mention that to the college.
If we ban that altogether, I'm jacking it all in.
Yeah.
If we get to that point, I'm jacking the whole lot. I'm just going to move to an island somewhere.
I'll let us trade a secret out. Anne Marie makes pizzas at 3
in
the morning.
Okay, good. Anne Marie. And I will fight to the death to give so you have the right to do so.
But basically, then they come together and look, being honest, but research can't exist without money. And the Irish Cancer Society gets 5% of their funding from the government. The rest comes from items like Daffodil Day, Pink Ribbon, whatever, all their different events, and really is becoming one of their flagship events. So teams will raise money pre the event. They'll raise some money at the event through their different stalls and one thing or another. But there's no fixed, you must raise this or you must raise that or you must do the other. No, it's up to everybody's generosity to do the best that they can.
And can I just say as well, it's just, you know, when you talk about a group of 10, it could just be 10 friends.
Yeah, exactly.
Out for the crack. Yeah. And you have the gazebo, you bring up a thing that you're sheltered in. You know, people bring sleeping bags and you know, sleep under there.
If it
there.
Comes down to the gazebo, I'm sure we can rustle up a gazebo.
Oh, yeah.
We'll not worry about
absolutely.
It.
No, absolutely.
And if you can't, exactly. And if you can't enter a team or you don't want to, support a team.
Support a team.
Exactly.
The website is there. I mean, you can find a team on the website, the Ready for Life Donegal website. There's a button to click. If you can't get your own team, join a team. Teams are always looking for it.
Yeah.
So as I say, fundraising, I suppose, has started. I've been at a couple of events already, and that'll continue all the way up until the event. But the focus then on the event is that the team then promotes themselves during the event. After the survivor's lap, there's a carer's lap, and carers are extremely important. Then there's the team lap, and the teams have their own banner, and all the group has much come together, and they walk around the pitch and they get introduced. And the friendship that they make. Now, we have this year so far, about a third of the teams are new teams. Two-thirds of the teams are returning teams. And already I'm getting requests, where are you putting us this year? We want to be beside such and such a teams because we had great crack last year. Again, top secret, the Donegal Firefighters Association have a team in this year, and the amount of requests I'm getting from teams to be sitting next to them. Don't know why they want to be there.
Maybe it's the pizzas.
No. they can put out the fire. If there's a fire, we can put out the fire. But as I say, the other group that... Again, it's a big attraction is the Donald's involved, as you probably know, in the ukulele orchestra.
Of course, yeah.
They have a team in it, and the crack that they have at 2 a.m, they're out on the pitch. As people are walking past, they're playing music, and it's wonderful.
Yeah, it's so, something else.
It's just something else, yeah.
Buy a candle bag,
yeah.
What's this about?
The luminaria, that's the candle bag or luminaria service, it takes place at about 10:20 on the Saturday night. Music goes down, the mood goes down. We have a wonderful ceremony, again, led by Donal. Donal is amazing at that. Moya Brennan is playing at it. Candle bags are bought, purchased in memory of someone that you're thinking of who may no longer be with us or who's undergoing a treatment or is, thank God, out the other side. Somebody is away, someone you can't... But the candles are placed in an oval shape all around the pitch. And it's an amazing sight to see almost 5,000 candle bags lit and put up. It's a tremendous effort.
Did you ever see that?
Greg? I did, yeah.
It is eerie. It's
and I think, again, because we're all so individual, it can be sort of like a celebration of someone's life, or it can be... It's up to the individual. It's so subjective, isn't it?
It is.
And you can see it in different ways in different years.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
If you're feeling up, or if you're feeling...
It brings you... Exactly. Yeah. But it's quite
Which
powerful.
Is fine. People should not be afraid of those emotions.
Correct.
Either.
No, yeah. Absolutely.
And it's right to remember people who are no longer with us.
Yeah.
Look, I lost my own dad in 1986, and if cancer treatment research had been there, he'd still be alive since 86, but he wouldn't have gone.
What you're on about. Longer with him.
You would have much longer with him. So the candle bags are a really important part. We'll be selling those on you'll be seeing pop-up shops throughout the county in the next... They'll be starting, I think, next week, and they'll be going on all the way through to the event. You can also get your candle bag online, or you can get your candle bag at the event itself.
This is not a closed shop or a group or a team or a membership. This is for absolutely everybody listening to this programme right across the community. We broadcast from there as well. There's brilliant, and it's a mixture of music. You can have sort of like a trad, brass, Callum Keaveney, Daniel O'Donnell perhaps on stage. It's just a big old mixed bag of whatever. Just drift in and drift out.
And can I just say something as well, Greg?
Anything you want to, Magella.
Thank you, dear. People, you know, I've been out there some years and the weather is like really bad and it's raining, you know. And the numbers aren't great. But it's the weather, it's terrible, it's a shame. I was there another year and the sun was splitting in the rocks. Oh, it's a shame the weather's like this because they're all off the beach. Do you know, I mean, one day a year, give it up. Give it up for your fellow, you know, people.
I would love to see record numbers this year because, parking is really, really good there. There's a ton of parking there.
Greg, just on that point on numbers, one of my goals, I've taken over, as you know, from chairman from Robert this year, one of my goals is to increase the number of survivors taking part at Relay this year. And as part of that process, we're actually going out to the community. You already said in the introduction, this is not Letterkenny Relay. We're setting up meetings in four different areas. We're going to Buncrana, we're going to Donegal Town, we're going to Bunbeg, and we're holding one in Balbuffet. So those meetings are going to be coming up in the month of April, and we're going to be promoting those. My aim is to go out to those regions and invite survivors to come along to our let's call it a workshop, and to let the survivors know what we're doing at Relay for Life. And if my intention is if I can get 20 extra survivors from each of the four regions, that'll put another 80 to 100 people on the pitch. And that to me, survivors are the most important part of why we're doing this.
It's on the 25th, 26th of May, 2024. So, you know, organise it now. If there's someone who doesn't have a car close to you or whatever, say, look, do you want to head over there on that day? I'll drive us down. They can get to experience it as well. It's all part of the thing. Magella, you know, obviously, you did amazing with your diagnosis and the early part of your treatment and what have you. You know, you put a face to it. People could relate to you. And it did an awful lot of good in that regard. How important is it, do you think, and you mentioned Charles and Kate, and I think particularly Kate, because you wouldn't imagine, you know, 40-year-old...
What is she, 42, yeah.
You know...
Yeah.
I'm not saying beautiful people don't get cancer, don't get me wrong, but it's you don't see it that often. Mm-hmm. Not saying it doesn't happen that often, but you don't see it. How important is it, maybe more for the British public, but I think certainly for the Irish public as well, that... You know, people see other people that are famous or well known or what have you. You know, it relatable or something. We do see an uptick in GP visits and contacts and stuff, don't we?
Yes. I mean, I think when you see somebody in like Kate's position or whatever, or a celebrity, myself, you kind of think, you know, well, they can have the best of everything. They can have the best doctors. They can have the best, you know, screening and all that kind of thing. Well, when you see somebody like Kate that's got it, you realise that, you know, cancer is, as I said, it's not choosy about. Yeah. And it's important, I think. Well, I mean, going on another thing altogether, the whole thing with Kate, you know, the conspiracy is because she didn't say what was happening. So, you know, the fact that she came out and said it, it's like, oh, Christ, okay, that's what that is, and what a shame. And like I say, 42 years of age, you just never know when that...
We're going to do, just off the back of that, me and Caroline, we've just had a pre-production meeting, and we're going to do something about how you tell children, how you communicated. I know there's great advice out there from, but I just think it might be a useful conversation for us to have on the radio. The reason she says she kept it as quiet as she did is because she had to get her children,
get
all that processed.
Absolutely.
So we shouldn't forget, we don't own these people. And I'm not talking about the royals.
No.
I'm on about every people who are in every family. Yeah. Exactly.
Sure.
Right, okay, so the big date, the 25th, 26th of May, 2024. No,
and it's
excuses.
Just 24 hours.
Yeah,
4 p.m.
Exactly.
to 4 p.m.
And no excuses, whether it's wet or too hot.
I say that like crowd. When you're lying in bed sick with chemotherapy or whatever, what you wouldn't give to go out in the rain and walk. You know what I mean? Just to feel normal enough to be able to go outside. So don't let weather be a reason for not coming, whether it's good, bad or indifferent. Please come. We're all going to be there. It'll be a great day.
Yeah, Seamus, it's obvious that you know, you want to reach as much as you can.
I
hope it all pays dividends. Use us.
Thank you.
Like your favourite rag. If you need any further assistance.
No, we're really appreciate
it. This is only the start of it, really. I mean, it's a big, it's a couple of months to go. So there's no excuse not to make arrangements now and organise a bus or gather up a team if you're in Carrigan's or Carrigart or Pettigo or wherever it is. Get a team together and come along and share the experience.
That's it. Absolutely.
Anything you want to add, Seamus, or Magella?
Just one little things on the survivorship. Having met so many now over the last number of years, one of the things that really strikes me as a committee person is when a survivor comes up to you and says thanks for doing this for us. Like, they have met complete random strangers who are going through the same thing as themselves. They sat down with them for a cup of tea or cup of coffee in the canteen for 10-15 minutes. And they know they're not alone. They know there's people out there that has gone through the exact same as they're going through. Random strangers that they're able to talk to. It's not easy always talking to your own family. It's not easy talking to the doctors or the nurses. You don't get a feeling for it. And to hear a survivor coming up and giving you a hug and saying, thank you for doing this for us, it makes it special.
Yeah. And if I had called my sister or mom a survivor, I'd have got a kick in the ghoulies.
Yeah.
So that's not a word for everyone, but it doesn't mean that you shouldn't attend. You know what I mean? You can just go in and... I know the majority do, but it's not for everyone.
It's not for everyone.
It's not, as I say, having been someone who's there, it's not it's you just need to go and you'll understand what we're talking about. Right, Seamus Devine, chair of Relay for Life Donegal. The best of luck with everything that you're all trying to do and carrying on the superb work from those that went before you, and bringing your ideas to it as well. Magella O'Donnell, the newly appointed co-patron of Relay for Life Donegal. It'll be elbows at dawn between you and Daniel over the 24 hours. Okay, listen, thanks so much for giving us so much of your time.
See you all on the 25th of May.
Yes, and Magella's not taking any excuses. Just beyond the guard there. Right, back shortly.
Watch the show live now on YouTube, Facebook and at highlandradio.com.
Sleep under the stars at one of Ireland's top glamping destinations, Lochmardle Lodge in South Donegal, offering lakeside eco-lodge with luxury yurts and shepherd's huts. Perfect for a family getaway or a romantic escape. Get 10% off with discount code MARDLE for bookings made by end of April. To book, call 086 02 33360 or visit lochmardleglamping.ie.
Find all the fresh seafood you know and love at your local Dunstores Fishmonger. Marinate and pan-sear a succulent 250-gram hake fillet, only €3, and serve with mango salsa. Pick up a 180-gram pack of beautiful king prawns, only €3.59, or 3 for €10, cooked with your favourite spices or dressing. Plus, you can save at the till with a 5 off 25 grocery voucher. Dunstores, always better value. Terms and conditions apply. Voucher can be used on next in-store grocery shop of €25 or more.
Looking for that Brooks experience? Try the new range at bmcsports.ie. New Ghost Max Glycerin 21 or the Adrenaline GTS 23. Step into our safe size experience so we can fit the best trainer for your foot. Let us make your trainer experience the best it can be. Brian McCormick Sports, Main Street, Letterkenny.
If you need a new laptop, enjoy super fast performance and seamless multitasking with Avita Laptops at Ben Swinney Euronics. Avita laptops are equipped with advanced processors and ample RAM, so they handle everything from work to entertainment with ease. They come with a 2-year warranty and prices starting at only €449. For more details, pop in and see us at Ben Swinney Euronics, Port Road, Letterkenny, or in the shopping centre, Dunloe.
Charlie McClafferty Funeral Directors, serving Letterkenny and the surrounding areas for over 100 years. Charlie McClafferty Funeral Directors. Let our family take care of your family and guide you through a difficult time.
Looking for your perfect exclusive wedding venue? The Red Door Country House is nestled on a 4-acre site on the shores of Lough Swilly, located in Fáin Bunchrana. We are offering a reduced package price for remaining dates this year. Contact info at thereddoor.ie for all your wedding inquiries.
New this week in Home Store and More. All ironing boards are all half price. That's right, half price. But better hurry, because when all the half price ironing boards are gone, they're gone. Also, all Pyrex kitchenware is still all half price. But when all the half price Pyrex kitchenware is gone, it's definitely gone. Drop by your local Home Store and More. Visit us online at homestoreandmore.ie. New store now open in Frascati Centre, Blackrock. Home Store and More. A happy home.
Century Complex is a perfect destination for your family day out this Easter, with lots of options in Backstage Bar and Grill, a selection of movies and Century Cinemas, and don't forget our Easter party in Century Play on Sunday the 31st of March from 10:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. for that final hurrah before our extensive renovations begin. Check out our website at centurycinemas.ie.
Chachtracht ar waithe le leasán phobail ó chóirle condaí Winnanal. Is é an tamseo den bhliain a bhfuil drá chuinne le hachamana i cruthú timpistí. A an rá isagat ná féidir obair aspraile a eil janta ar scíhan scrípe ná deisiú dinge a hamháin ag obrithóir deimhnithe a bhfuil teastas ceadaithe bailí aige ó chóirle condaí Winnanal. Ní mór don ina deisiúthe cáilitheach ná don ghrair sa teastas bailí a thuispeáint. I cruthú go ndearna cigireacht orthu agus go gcomhlíonann siad ceanglais na reachtaíochta, pentina measla, na dreoirlínse dealaíochtas an áthmhail chríochnú fichle agus an acta cruailiú air. Le haghaidh liosta suas an d'áite de oibreoirí deimhnithe, seiceáil Lightrun gréasáin na cóirle ná chur glaoch orainn ag 9:05, 9:09. Cóirle condaí Winnanal ag cosáint na timpeallachta.
hop to it with Easter savings at Tesco. Our Board B approved finest whole leg of lamb, now half price. Don't forget the mint jelly. Our Board B approved Irish Angus Carvery rib roast is half price too. And Villa Maria Sauvignon Blanc was €13.50, now €10. Enjoy a bigger and better Easter. Tesco. Every little helps. Club card required, subject to availability. Available in most stores. Prices vary in express stores. See Tesco.ie. Enjoy alcohol responsibly.
A Highland Radio weather update with Ireland West Airport. Time to book that business trip to London. Fly daily to London Stansted and Luton with Ryanair and London Heathrow with Aer Lingus. Ireland West Airport. Don't just take off, take it easy.
So it's mostly cloudy today with outbreaks of rain and drizzle becoming lighter and patchier as the day goes on. Highest temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees with mostly light to moderate easterly winds, fresh near the coasts. And I couldn't help but notice that, and my heart breaks if it is the case, that the weather's not looking fantastic for those of you that might be heading to Portugal and Spain. If you're lucky enough to get away on the Easter break, hopefully it's not as bad as some are suggesting. But I know if it were I'd be watching very keenly to see what the story is. Patricia, involved with Relay for 12 years, we walked through rain, sun and still had a smile on our faces at the end of this wonderful event. Me and my two sisters had cancer in the past 3 years. My thyroid, my older sister, lung, and my young sister, who's 45, has ovarian cancer that spread to her brain. I'm so sorry, so sorry to hear what you're going through. And I wish you all the very, very best. What an awful blow for all of you. Very sad to hear that. Last night, RTE showed the games where there was something at stake. The Armagh game and the Donegal game, plus the Monaghan Division 1, were not shown. The idea that RTE is something against Donegal is ridiculous. Anyway, I'm sure Jim would like to stay under the radar. That comes from James. As I say, James, I'm only just kind of reflecting what I hear out and about. Morning, Greg. Just after hearing on Highland, the average house price in Donegal is £162,000. If this is true, why is it taking £425,000 to replace our Micah homes? Well, you see, it's three bed semis apparently are going for £162,000 here. If there's any, that's the average price apparently across the whole county. So that could be out in the sticks, it could be in the heart of Letterkenny, but on average, £162,000 for a three bed semi sounds low to me. Like, are those houses actually out there? Let me know. Any reason why I couldn't pay cash to get into the Donegal game yesterday, Greg? Me and my family went to it and weren't allowed in. The five of us had to go home again. Ridiculous. It wasn't even close to being sold out either. That comes from Noel. Well, they don't, as a rule, take cash on the turnstiles, Noel. And we were told by the Mary Coughlin, who's the head of the GAA in this county, that that was down to governance and what have you. They did have, for one of the games, was it the last game, they did have one cash stall, did they? I think. I don't know. Very disappointing for you. Did he just leave or what's the crack? BBC Northern Ireland always covers Donegal in GEA sports news. RTE never. Same as Finn Harps Soccer Club. That's a fact. That caller believes they're both GEA, Donegal GEA and Finn Harps not getting the coverage. Why did Micheál Martin not move back to Taoiseach? They were sharing the job before. Well, it's the not the individuals that share the job. It is the parties. So it's Fine Gael's turn. And if they lose their leader, then it is Fine Gael's turn, really effectively. So that's why. Why does nobody mention the fact that under the Lisbon Treaty, Ireland and Denmark have an out clause regarding asylum seekers? We are under no EU obligation to take these asylum seekers into Ireland. Why are we being lied to? That's a conversation we've had very regularly on this programme, the most recent on Friday, I believe. Personally, I have my apprehensions of Simon Harris as Taoiseach, as he was health minister when the abortion referendum was passed. I strongly disagree with abortion, they say. Thank you to the kind soul who handed in my phone in Asda. I left my phone in a trolley in Asda, and someone has handed it in. The phone had all my cards and everything in it, so thanks so much. Good news. That's good news. But I don't get why people get those with little envelopes. Not little envelopes, but the little folder phones, the covers, and they have their entire life contained within that space. But look, anyway, good that you got it back. Morning, Greg. It's very unfortunate for people renting a home to be asked to leave because the landlord wants to sell the property, but it's most definitely not the problem of the landlord. There's an election coming up, so hope people remember what government caused this problem. Thank you. If you patch up the cracks in your defective home, are you put on the bottom of the list again for repair? Well, I don't know what the story is there. Someone out there might know. I presume I would have guessed, and maybe I shouldn't, that the engineer's report is what dictates the process, right? So if you get the engineer's report and then you get testing done and it shows what level of mica is there and what have you, cosmetically blocking the cracks so that your house is, you know, maybe you're not reminded all the time of exactly what's going on. Surely that shouldn't trump the core sampling or an engineer's report. But I don't know. It shouldn't. But someone out there will know what the situation is and will let us know, I'm sure. Please, 086 60 25000.
Hi folks, Paul McDevitt here, inviting you to join myself and Jimmy Stafford this Monday night for another edition of the Monday Night Sessions. With his latest album released on Friday, we welcome back one of Ireland's top vocalists, the brilliant Davy Fury. And from Clonmany, making their Monday Night Sessions debut, we welcome the Two Bucks. We'll also be playing some of the latest releases from around the Northwest and the rest of the country. So that's the Monday Night Sessions, this Monday night, between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. right here on Highland Radio.
If you know the beauty and skincare product that suits you best, you'll find them at McGee's Chemist Letterkenny. From moisturisers, cleansers and toners to day creams and night creams, McGee's have the top brands you know and love, like Lancôme, Clarins and La Roche-Posay. Also Elizabeth Arden, Vichy, Nukes and many more. All at McGee's Chemist Main Street Letterkenny and online at mcgees.ie. For the best, costs less.
Skoda cars are made for exploring Ireland. But let's add more style, more sexiness, more French. Skoda Fabia, Scala and Kamiq models are available in the Monte Carlo range. Black exterior details, excusez-moi, sports seats and bumpers, enchanté, and carbon decor. So chic. Order your new 2024 Skoda with more je ne sais quoi at skoda.ie. Skoda, let's explore.
Your local Skoda dealer is DMG Motors, Clare Road, Donegal Town. Telephone 074-97-21396 or visit dmgmotors.ie.
The life of a Charlie's chip is never dull. Once they're selected, they're off to Charlie's, where they lose their jacket, have a nice wash and get into shape. Before going out, there's always a few nerves, totally unnecessary, because, let's face it, they always go down well. Enjoy Charlie's chips to sit in or take away, daily, from 12 to 8 at Pierce Road, Letterkenny. When the hunger hits, pull into Charlie's.
Glenswilly GAA Bingo Easter Special this Wednesday 27th at 8:30. Three chances of winning €500. All other houses 100. All lines €40. Free Easter hamper giveaway on the night to thank our customers for their loyal support. This Wednesday at Glenswilly GAA Hall.
And now, IMRO's 2023 Best Local or Regional News Programme, the voice of the Northwest, the 9 till noon show with Greg Hughes.
Okay, another hour on the way. Stay right where you are. It's another interesting one. But first, let's get a news update at 11, and it's over to Michaela Clark.
Thanks, Greg. Good morning. Speculation is now turning to who will make up the Fine Gael side of cabinet after Simon Harris was elected as leader of the party yesterday. The higher education minister ran unopposed, which meant he was installed as Leo Varadkar's replacement. Simon Harris says he will speak to current ministers to assess their positions and policy ahead of his election as Taoiseach when the Dáil returns from the Easter recess. The HSE has confirmed some physiotherapy services may return to St Joseph's Hospital Stranorlar. There were fears earlier this year that the HSE was attempting to reduce services at the community hospital as physiotherapy services were withdrawn and relocated to Lifford and Donegal Town. Father Lorcan Sharkey, Vice Chair of the Save Our St Joseph's Hospital Committee, says assurances were given at a meeting over the weekend to return a number of services to a premises close to the facility. A car stolen in Strabane has been found in Donegal, stripped of its parts. It's after what police have described as a well-planned and organised theft. The white Audi Q7 was stolen after a property in Brackengate was entered and the keys of the vehicle taken yesterday between 12:30 and 1 a.m. Working with Gardaí, the Audi was later found on a remote forest road near Loch Hill Bog, close to Ballybuffet. The future of people living in defective block social properties remains uncertain. Councillor Liam Blaney says some minor repair works were carried out on a number of years ago, but since then there has been a lack of communication with the inhabitants. He's urging Donegal County Council to step in while they await a scheme to remediate the social homes. The future of the fisheries in the EU is centre stage at a meeting in Belgium today. An informal meeting of ministers is taking place, which will discuss ways to protect and boost the sector. Minister for the Marine Charlie McConlogue welcomes the opportunity to discuss the future of the industry. There's calls for Donegal County Council to develop a plan for convoy. Councillor Patrick McGowan believes the growth of population in the town warrants a review of infrastructure. He says convoy is acting as a satellite town for Letterkenny and the expansion of it must be plan-led. And police have issued a warning after a helicopter pilot reported a near miss with a drone in the vicinity of Foyle Bridge in Derry yesterday afternoon. The drone was operating at an altitude of 1,000 feet, which is both illegal and extremely dangerous for the aircraft and occupants. Those are the latest headlines. We'll be back with an update again at 12 noon.
Thank you, Michaela.
Return. Ireland's deposit return scheme is now live and we're bringing it back. In addition to a refundable deposit on Return logo plastic bottles and cans, during the transition period, there may be a deposit on drinks containers that don't have a Return logo. But remember, if you pay a deposit, you'll get it back when returned to reverse vending machines in participating shops nationwide. Let's get returning together and ensure better recycling for Ireland. For more, visit return.ie.
All right, you're very welcome back to the programme. If you want to text or WhatsApp us, the lines remain open for you on 086 60 25,000, or you can give us a call on 074 91 25,000. We're joined in studio by Laura Byrne. Hi, Laura.
Hello, good morning.
Good to have you on the show. James Corran is with us as well, and John Sheridan, both of you, thanks so much.
Thank you, Greg. Good morning. Thanks.
Right, okay. Now, you are part of Elevate 55. Illuminati 8 Youth Work, is that the correct, or is that just a typo?
Oh, I think that's a typo. We are part of the IMUS group, which is the Irish Youth Music Awards.
I'm all for typos.
This is a little bit off.
This is beyond.
It's okay.
This is beyond a typo. Right. James Corran's a soloist going to the Irish Youth Soloist Awards in Dublin. John Sheridan, part of the band New Normal, also heading to the Irish Youth Awards. So that's what we're talking about. The awards taking place in May. Who wants to pick it up?
Go
on, talk to us about the competition.
Yeah. So the Irish Youth Music Awards is a national programme and we are the Donegal hub. There's about 20 hubs across the country. It's a youth programme and the idea of the programme is to give young people an insight into the music industry and then also the opportunity to take part in the national event, which is happening in the RDS in Dublin. And that event is full of workshops with industry professionals and some really, really like incredible stages that these guys are soon to have the opportunity to get a chance to get a spot on this week.
James, talk to me about your art. You're a soloist. So what does that mean? That's your solo artist?
So I just play by myself on the on stage. So I write songs, which, I just write songs.
So you sing and accompany yourself?
Yes, I sing by myself. I play the guitar by myself.
Yeah.
I have no band backing me up, so sometimes I rely on the crowd, like for certain songs, to clap along, to keep me in time.
Yeah, exactly.
And perform a bit better and give them a better show.
Definitely. Artists don't often like to sort of compare themselves, but just for the benefit of the listeners, who would you sort of say, genre-wise, you're most similar to? Or
Well, for the song that I've been writing, I've been told it's very like Nirvana.
Right, okay.
Just the way I kind of sing it. I would like to think of myself with like stage presence, the same kind of stage presence as John Lydon of the Sex Pistols.
So you leave it all out there.
Yeah.
And are you a soloist by choice? Like, is that the way you want to do it? Do you not work well with other people? What's the story?
Well, I'm an only child, so yeah.
All right, so it's all starting to add up.
So yeah. But no, I'm a part of a band called The Air Bears.
Right, okay.
We actually met through The Loft. It was a band camp, I believe.
Yeah.
About a year ago in August. I just decided I'll try to do it by myself, you know.
Yeah, I mean, there's pros and cons, isn't there?
Yeah.
And also, too, it's if you want to really challenge yourself to go out there and, you know, engage and entertain an audience. John, you're part of the New Normal band. Yeah. You're heading down there as well.
Yeah.
You're no stranger to Highland Ready. You've been in and out a few times. So talk to us, New Normal. How long has this outfit been about?
New Normal has been a band that I started about, give or take, 3 months or so.
Yeah.
We kind of, me and the guitar player, Rory Halpin, we've spoken a couple of years ago about starting a band, like, and we never really thought much of it, and then he messaged me just December past there, and he had said just about if we were still thinking on it, and I just said, I will, if you want to, and kind of we went from there.
Yeah.
And we've been practicing ever since in the loft here.
Yeah. And in terms of the direction, I mean, are you doing your own stuff, a mixture of covers and your own stuff, or what's the...
It's kind of covers, and we're in the process of kind of writing more of
I think covers
stuff.
For bands, especially new bands, I think, you know, there's no harm in covers.
Aye.
I think, you know, it gives a band its space then to grow itself.
Yeah.
I think some people might go, oh, I don't want to do covers or what have you, but to put your own interpretation on them, whatever it might be. But I think, you know, as a new band, it gives you material as you work on your own material. I think there's a bit of logic to that. So, Laura, how many through Elevate 55, i.e. The Loft, or... AKA or formerly The Loft.
Yeah.
So what's your what is the Elevate 55's role in this in terms of user bringing the bands down or just assisting with the organisation?
The programme itself is a programme where they are involved in workshops. So far we've had workshops with Maria McCormack and we've had a songwriting workshop. So part of the programme is creating their own piece and their own composition. In order to get onto one of the live stages in Dublin, it has to be a piece of their own and then a cover as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been part of the programme so far. I've been working closely with Maria to really nurture that and look at songwriting skills, and they've been really good, like, fun workshops, haven't they? Mm-hmm. We've also worked closely with the Eric Arts team. We had a workshop with them looking at how to curate a festival and just looking at some of, like, the logistics involved and the work that goes behind standing up on stage and performing. So part of our work in the programme so far is looking at that workshop and personal development, looking at you as an artist as a whole and the skill set that you need. And then in addition to that, we've had our monthly gig nights. So again, that's building upon, like, bands' repertoires, their skills on getting up to performing, and then even setting up the PA system, giving us a hand and making sure that everyone knows what they're doing.
Yeah, because if you want to have a go at it, there's much more to it than just getting up there.
There really is,
you know, especially
is,
if you're in a band, you know, often you become your own promoter, you have to sell the stuff as well. We had that when we were running our music competition here. I think it's annual, I'm not sure if it's going again. But, you know, you can still be cool, but you still have to push yourself. You still have to promote it. There's more to it. Simply, I mean, if you look at, like, what Ed Sheeran does on socials, I know this is not a fantastic example, but or even someone like James Blunt, for crying out loud.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Or Lewis Capaldi, you know. And it's not just those sort of mainstream acts others do too. There's a function behind everything they're doing.
Definitely.
It's brand recognition, it's reach, it's whatever it takes to get your song in someone's ears. So there's much more to it, perhaps. And now with the... I think artists have far more control now because they're not reliant on a big break or something. You know, it's great if you get that, but you can build organically from the down up, from the ground up, can't you? And also, too, people grow outside of the music, don't they, themselves? I'm not sure, James, have you ever had any issue with confidence? I'm not sure you do, but I mean, I presume you've found yourself developing as a person through your music too?
Well, I do kind of have some problems with confidence.
We all do.
It's just like, in my own experience, you're really nervous before going up on stage and then you just kind of blank out.
Yeah.
It's just like, That's the kind
see,
of
we always see nervousness as a bad thing.
No.
But that's adrenaline, that's the rush, mm-hmm. that's what yeah. drives you through it, you know. And if you come off a show like this, or you come off at a gig, you're exhausted, mm. right? People think I just sit here and talk, but there's an awful lot going on, right?
I can imagine, yeah.
You'd be exhausted. And yeah. for people who don't do this type of stuff, they don't get that. They don't understand how you can be emotionally drained, how you can be physically drained as well, yeah. Just by talking or focusing an awful lot. So there is a fundraiser coming up, John, isn't there, as yeah. well? This is to sort of assist, really, I suppose, in shifting everyone from up here to down
yeah,
there.
Exactly. Like, that's happening now on Wednesday, the 27th, in Theo's Bar in the Orchard Inn. And we've got a lineup, myself, my band New Normal, and James, and a lot of other musicians are going to be there. And we've got a raffle as well, a good few spot prizes to go along with that. And that's just for the voting to kind of see who gets a spot on the main stage.
Mm. Oh, right, so there's still that's sort of yes. part of this, is it,
yeah.
Laura?
Yeah,
okay,
that's part
right.
of it.
I thought
well.
this was just a fundraiser as such.
Yeah, so it is fundraising. That's one element
right,
to it.
I get
the
you.
Other element is we have Michelle joining us from the National Office in Dublin.
Okay.
And she's going to be hosting the voting selection. So that is an opportunity for these guys to perform their own pieces and for the spot of getting onto the main stage when we get there to RDS in May. So everybody, all of us are going to go down together and we're
Brilliant.
All going to be supporting each other, but there is that opportunity there to bag a spot on the main
okay,
stage.
Okay, so the fundraiser stroke bag a spot thingamajig is in the Orchard in Letterkenny on Wednesday the 27th of March, which is the day after tomorrow, in
yeah.
fact.
Yeah.
€10 in, including food. Is that right?
Nipples yeah.
or something?
Yeah,
okay.
Yep, got a good deal.
Doors open at 7 p.m. The fundraiser has been organised to assist the young musicians, as we've been listening from the Loft in Letterkenny, to get to the Youth Awards. And tickets, I don't know what's capacity like there.
We do have some tickets left available. We've got about 20 tickets left available.
Okay.
So if you contact
so it's supposed to sell out then.
Close to a sellout. And if you contact the Donegal Youth Service, then we can get a ticket reserved for you. That's no problem.
Brilliant. And supporting young musicians as well,
yeah.
too, the stars of the future.
And I think one of the most important things is that the guys that are part of the programme have organised this themselves.
Yeah.
So they've been organising all of the PR, they've sorted out the lineup for it, they're going to be sorting out all of the sound system themselves. So they've really driven this event for themselves as well, which is a really good experience.
Great stuff. Anything, James, John, you want to add?
I think that's more or less.
Well, listen, and when's the actual event in Dublin? When is that?
The event in Dublin is the 18th of May.
Yeah. All right, so it's only around the corner. Exciting yeah. stuff. Well, listen, good luck to you.
Thanks for calling in.
And there's a few tickets available for this coming Wednesday, a little bit of a midweek treat for you. It's in the Leo's Bar, did you say it's called?
Leo's.
I'm not a drinker, really, you see. I just don't know that. It's a fundraiser in the Orchard, Letterkenny, on Wednesday night. Doors open at 7. Reserve your tickets for €10. Includes food as well. And where did you say again? Sorry.
If you contact the Donegal Youth Service, ask for Laura, and we can get a ticket reserved for you.
All right,
you.
Good stuff. Thanks, Laura. Thanks, James.
Thank you, John.
Good luck Wednesday night. Good luck in Maesland. See you soon.
The county's number one talk show, The 9 Till Noon Show on Highland Radio.
Have you entered our €10,000 home makeover draw? If the answer is yes, then you are now automatically entered into our extra cash giveaway. If the answer is no, then now is the time to enter. Greg Hughes will be ringing one lucky person on Thursday the 28th of March and again on Friday the 5th of April, giving you the chance to win twice. That's not all. You will still have the chance of winning in our main draw of a €10,000 home makeover in association with Foy & Company, plus €5,000 in cash. Go to highlandradio.com now. Click on Win a Home Makeover, answer a simple question, and purchase your ticket. Imagine the possibilities.
Craving a taste of bliss by the water? Dive into deliciousness at the Water's Edge in Rathmullen. Our coffee and snack bar offers a daily dose of freshness and flavour, from scrumptious light bites to tasty snacks and freshly brewed coffee. Served daily from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and delicious fresh pizza served daily from 12 p.m. See you soon at the Water's Edge.
Do you suffer from high cholesterol, menopause symptoms, digestive issues, anxiety, aches and pains, or a lack of energy? The highly trained team at the Natural Way Letterkenny can provide advice on natural remedies for a number of individual health issues. The Natural Way also has its own brand of herbal treatments to help fight fatigue, relieve digestive discomfort, maintain a healthy immune system and alleviate common menopause symptoms. The Natural Way at Letterkenny Shopping Centre, your one-stop health shop.
If you need advice on what's best for coughs or colds, or what's best for sore throats or flu, just ask at your local Brennan's Pharmacy. If you need advice on the best vitamins and tonics to put a pep in your step, just ask at your local Brennan's Pharmacy. Whether it's about backaches, headaches or tummy aches, your Brennan's Pharmacy team can help. If you need advice from someone you trust, we're here for you at your local Brennan's Pharmacy, Buncrana, Clonmany and Creeslaw.
Look no further than iMotors for your next car.
With a vast selection of top quality used vehicles to choose from, we have something for every budget and lifestyle.
Whether you're searching for a reliable starter car, a spacious SUV or a sleek sports car, our friendly team is here to help you find the perfect match.
Visit iMotors.ie and discover why we are the go-to destination for used cars in the Northwest.
Elevate your style at Evolve Clothing, Letterkenny Retail Park and evolveclothing.com. Easter sale happening now. Massive discounts on all stock.
Right, this evening, just after 7 o'clock, it is the DL Debate, Highland Radio's GEA podcast, and its presenter and compiler is Brendan Devenny. Good morning to you, Brendan. Thanks so much for calling in. How are you keeping?
Oh, very best.
All right, busy weekend, wasn't it?
It was a busy one, especially as my wife had hopped off to Westport on a hen. So
isn't that nice for her?
The baby,
it is a woman's life, you know.
Listen, she...
Because you never leave
she deserved
house.
That. The Unions boys were calling me the juggler there by Sunday morning because I was running here and there and everywhere trying to keep up with everything. But listen, sure, without the family, you'd be in bother, you know.
What's your focus this weekend, Brendan? I mean, obviously, sort of an awful lot has been settled from a league perspective in the men's game.
Yeah, indeed. Listen, last game was hard to know what to read into. Very strange match, actually, Saturday evening. Greg, you know, took so long to get going. 23 minutes in, we had a point on the board. And by the end of half, we had 10. You know, it kind of just started happening.
What happens there?
I don't know. Meath were sitting pretty deep. We kind of owned the ball. We just were a bit slow at opening them up. And it was all a bit, you know, obvious what was happening.
Yeah.
We didn't seem to catch fire. And then, strangely enough, as I say, we reeled off 9 points then in the last 10 to 12 minutes. So, listen, it was one of those games where Meath himself rested players. You know, it wasn't a game for them of any importance. They were safe in the league. So it took us a while to get going. I think, you know, particularly, I suppose, a high point, maybe Jamie Brennan's goal in the second half kind of lit it up and put the game to bed in many ways. But listen, Jim, we spoke to him after the game just around his thoughts on where they were at. You know, we've a whole load of injuries. You know, we've this game in Armagh coming up next week, and that'll give us a good test pre-Derry. But getting players back is the big thing.
But this is, like, if you're in a building process, you know, surely you get to the point where Armagh's not part of that process? That is perhaps the first test. And, I mean, I know fans will look at that game against Armagh, and that's what they will judge Donegal on heading in towards Derry.
Yeah, I think the issue probably is Division 2 has been poor. See, going down on there, I thought it looked like it was getting a bit better. Teams were getting a bit better organised, and what we've seen was Donegal mixed the good with the bad, and that now, and of course, Jim's in and loads of injuries, there's new players, and so it's going to take us a while. But when we opened up against teams, you know, we destroyed them, absolutely buried them at times. So I think probably with Armagh, the game, the draw game, I don't think we played particularly well in it. We didn't really go after them. Maybe we will this time, Rick, but I think just for a solid game pre-Derry, because it's going to go up. It's not only Championship, of course, it's going to go up a few notches.
What have we yet to see under Jim McGuinness the second time round? Is it chasing a lead with against a good team, or do you think we've seen that already?
Yeah, I don't think we've ever been under the cosh that much. Calvin put it up this probably that evening, and you know, we had an unbelievable performance from Ashen Gallen, probably got us across the line there. That was a bit of a warning shot, I suppose, but it was all about the Armagh game. But again, I don't think we went for Armagh. If anything, Armagh probably played, you know, they played a lot of direct ball in the game. They kind of went after us a bit. Now, they were at home, of course, and I think it was... I don't think Jim really wanted to open up against him, and we still should have beat him. We had a couple of brilliant goal chances, and we look what Armagh have done to a couple of teams since. So, and particularly like the hammer and they give Cavan, like they had 2-12 in the first half and that. So what we're seeing with football is now, and obviously Jim's very aware of that, is that the old tactic when he was there before around sitting defence first and attacking, it's now very much high press, squeezing teams in, squeezing their kick out, and you've got to score upwards towards 20 points, you know, maybe something around 1-15, 16, 17 to win any of the, against any of the bigger teams. That's where it's at now, and I think you're seeing that change with Derry, who are coming down. There's actually a very kind of counter-attack defensive under Rory Gallagher, and you've seen now since Mickey comes in, he realises that they weren't going to score maybe enough to get them across the line. A lot of their games were very defensively set. Derry now are pushing out that bit more as well, and you're seeing that by all the sides. You know, it's all about very much attack-minded high scoring.
That works for the fans.
Yeah, listen, it makes it much more interesting. Listen, this, the game's high scoring, but yet it can be still a bit at times possession based. The possession thing, whenever a team drops off and the other team has the ball, there's a lull
like
in the game.
Almost, isn't it? Yeah.
So that's what you think you've seen the last night in terms of we owned the ball and Meath were sitting in the office. And there's no pressure on anybody. Yeah. That probably is, even though the game can end up high scoring, the game still in periods can get a bit, you know, pedestrian. And that's not what the GA used to be about. But listen, that's where it is.
Yeah, and this, I presume it's not the final product yet. Who's to say where it's going from yesterday? I don't know, Division 1, Division 2, anything else that you want to mention that you'll be talking about tonight?
Yeah, well, Paddy Bradley's on. Do you know what? Fascinating guy, Yvonne. Paddy's been obviously an unbelievable player in his day, and he's coached in Donegal club level and in Derry. He's coached underage football in Derry, and of course he came into our senior team last year, so very interesting just to talk to him about last year. You know, I'm sure there'll be I'm sure Donal Cavan is in the back writing a play maybe on this, what happened, Greg, because it was like such drama in terms of, and if you look at it now, Greg, listen, it was literally 5 or 6 days ago, I think Paddy Carr stepped away a year ago. And where we were at then, we, 4 or 5 days later, we had that terrible performance down Roscommon when we were already relegated. And look where we are now. We're heading to Croke Park.
But that work started, I think that the fans of where we're at now started even before Jim took over, though, in fairness. There was a little bit of a period.
That's
there.
That's what I'm saying. Aye, Paddy and Aidan O'Rourke, definitely, and I've been saying that constantly. They did steady the ship.
They really did.
Because, you know, we gave Derry a game last year. We went up to Omagh and beat Monaghan, and Monaghan ended up in the semi-final. So the fact that we did that, missing, like, there's about, I'd say, 10 players separate that could start or be involved in this team now. So, you know, 10 players potentially.
I keep hearing that. All those 10 players, different makers, winners, proven.
Oh, definitely. Okay, good. Definitely. Yeah.
Right, okay. So, Monaghan were relegated yesterday, weren't they?
Aye, they were okay.
Niall Cleary is coming on to talk about hurling.
Yeah, listen, the hurlers again, we keep saying it. I mean, crazy game out in the park against Tyrone. What's happening in the leagues there, the hurling leagues were all at 6 teams and they're going to 7, so 3 teams go up. So even, that was a semi-final between us and Tyrone. Now, the Setanta hurling team are away on holidays, so between that and injuries, Donegal were missing, you know, 9 or 10 players. So the fact that we still, I mean, Tyrone had 5 goals against us and, you know, it's a rare day that happens. So we still nearly beat them, which really bodes well going into it. But I think we would have liked the game against Derry. Then again, Mickey's saying you could have picked a couple of injuries pre-Nicky Raggard because it would have been full on. But listen, because we were down so many, we still had a chance right at the end. We had a long range free, could equalise the game. So it was a brilliant game. But to be down so many, like, to compete like that, it's great because we're stepping up into 2A next year along with Tyrone and with Derry. The leagues are all changing. So listen, phenomenal work by Mickey and
the side. Yeah, there's always good. There can be good in a defeat as well. Paddy Brawley on the weekend football, as you mentioned, and Maureen O'Donnell in talking ladies football as well.
Yeah, we finished off the league there, Greg, with a victory away to Tip. So well done to John McNulty and the side. You know, it's a good one. Now it's May 19th before they're out in Championship. So it's quite a long period, but listen, that's when Ulster kicks off. We're playing Armagh, which we've been with a few big ding-dongs within the last couple of years, so an interesting start for the ladies.
Looking forward to the summer of football. Yeah. I think there's an awful lot there, isn't there, and hurling, but I'm not going to feign an interest in hurling, although your enthusiasm for it actually sort of got me interested. But that's how it works, yeah, isn't it? Well, you know what, it's funny.
See that pedestrian thing we were just chatting about? Yeah. That doesn't happen in hurling.
No.
So you for a second, like, if you don't move that ball, yeah, someone's
coming
up.
You check your text and it's 1-3, it's just been scored.
If you're ever out keeping scores, it's funny, because there may be football there. There's so much time. Yeah. You're writing down who scored that and whatever, and maybe you might write a point about it. Whereas hurling, you put your head down, you look up and the ball's going over the bar. A couple of times I was doing games, I'm like, what happened there?
You just hope someone in the box is watching what's going on all the time. Yes. All right, brilliant stuff. So that is the Deal Debate tonight with Brendan Devaney, live just after the 7 o'clock news. Paddy Brawley's on talking football. Bradley. Yep. Maureen O'Donnell's on talking football as well. Niall Cleary on about the hurling. And Brendan, of course, in there in the midst of it all. Thanks so much, Brendan.
So great.
And if you don't get to watch that live, listen to that live this evening. Don't forget you can podcast it, as many of you do, and listen to it at your leisure when you're out walking or exercising or whatever you might be doing.
Watch the show live now on YouTube, Facebook and at highlandradio.com.
Enter the Virgin Media Playhouse for unbelievable value from Ireland's best broadband. Get 500 meg super fast reliable broadband for just €35 a month for 12 months. Switch in-store or at virginmedia.ie. Virgin Media, it's playtime.
T's and C's apply. See virginmedia.ie. Subject to location and availability. New customers only. 12-month contract. 500 meg broadband. €70 thereafter. Ireland's best broadband awarded by Umlaut. See virginmedia.ie/proof.
Do you need a little extra help staying in your home? At Bluebird Care, we offer a wide variety of Qmark-approved personalised home care services across Donegal. And our fully trained and committed staff will always meet your care needs with kindness, compassion and dignity. To get your personal home care assessment plan, visit bluebirdcare.ie or call our care team today on 07491 29562 and bring care home.
Mega Value Fun Fair this Easter. All rides only £2.50, excluding Stealth Bomber and Dodgems at Ebrington Square, Derry, Londonderry. From Friday, March 29th to Sunday, April 7th. From 2 p.m. until late every day. Treat the family to a great day out this Easter with Cullen's Mega Value Fun Fair at Ebrington Square, Derry, Londonderry.
The Loganair Easter sale is now on. Fly from City of Derry Airport to London Heathrow and Glasgow. Save up to 15% off over 1 million seats across the Loganair network. Book by 2nd April, travel from 26th April. Subject to availability, exclusions apply. Visit loganair.co.uk. Loganair, your journey, our joy.
We've one planet and it's ours to protect. From repairing, to swapping, to creating and recreating. Learn the changes you can make every Tuesday at 12:30 to live a little greener. Tune in to Ours to Protect with me, Donna Marie Doherty.
Ours to Protect is funded by Commissioner Mann with a television licence fee and is a partnership between Highland Radio and the Independent Broadcasters of Ireland. Check out ourstoprotect.ie for more information.
Okay, our Monday focus today is on the defective concrete crises. I think when a book is written, if a book is written about this, numerous chapters, or even hypothetically a book is written, there'll be probably a specific chapter on the People's Document. Now, how significant that turns out to be or not remains to be seen, but I do believe it is a significant part of the journey of this story, so to speak. We're joined on the programme now by Michael Doherty, a defective block campaigner. It's about the formation of this People's Document and a public meeting to be held tomorrow night, Tuesday, in the Inishowen Gateway Hotel, Bunkran, at 7 p.m. It seeks clarity from political parties and politicians on where they stand on their People's Document in advance of the local elections. And, you know, it's a little bit like this programme, and I try and emphasise to people when someone won't come on or doesn't speak on a topic, sometimes that in and of itself is the answer, even if you don't actually get an answer from them. Michael, good morning to you.
Good morning, Greg.
Right, OK, so I think, you know, we've established what the People's Document is. Do you want to just, for those who don't know what it is, just in a paragraph, tell us what this piece of work is?
Yeah, this was work that kicked off at the end of October last year. It was between the campaign leaders, between Paddy Devers' group, Mike Action Group, Roisin Gallagher's redress focus groups, and we pulled together a definition of 100% redress. We felt that's what was lacking, because we had too many out there saying we're already getting it. And we were nothing that you could point to that would say, actually, we're not getting it because we're not getting these particular things that were being asked for. So what we went to go about doing was putting the people's document together, which was a definition of 100% redress. We put together what we thought was all the bases covered. It was there further. We introduced that then at the meeting in the Green Union, where we had about 800 people there. And we took their advice on what they thought should also be included. That was incorporated. It was then released to everyone. And on the 8th, that was a Monday the 4th, it was released on Friday the 8th to all the politicians, that be it all the TDs in the country, our MEPs, our senators, and our Donegal County Councillors. So they've all had it since the 8th of March. This is now going to be the 26th of March, so we're looking for their considered response on Tuesday night, tomorrow night, and we'll see what they've got to say for themselves regards their position against that document.
How does that work in the run-up to an election? And I'll just pick one party as random. Let's say just Fianna Fáil, right? So are you expecting a prospective candidate to sort of come back with the party line? Or would it be acceptable if they came back and said, you know, I think there are flaws, I'm going to work within the party to sort of try and make this more inclusive? Do you know what I mean? I'm just wondering how that looks. Are you looking for a party line? So in other words, are you looking for a situation, say, for instance, there were a vote in the council, a direction how Fianna Fáil might vote, say a no confidence motion or something like that, or Fine Gael, or Sinn Féin, or Aintu, or whoever it might be? Like, what do you want from...
Yeah, I think there's going to be two different parts to this. The first part will be those that are in power currently. So that's our Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, and Greens. We've got, obviously got no Greens in Donegal, so it's going to be represented through Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael. We need to hear what they believe, their opinion is on the people's document. Bearing in mind it is the people's document. Bearing in mind it's absolute light years away from the scheme that they currently preside over. You know, so if you're talking about at council level, we know that councillors don't have the power to implement the people's document. We understand that. But we do want to know what they believe in their heart of hearts. This has to be an honest meeting tomorrow night. They can't hide behind the party political lines, because when it comes to it, if they want to stand by the party that they represent, and the mistakes of the last two schemes, and they're still prepared to go down that road going forward, not even looking backwards, but going forward to still go down that road, then I think it's over to the people then to hear that firsthand.
I also think
for the people to say, are we just going to run with you doing the same thing again, or are we going to go for something different? The people need to know the truth.
But you know, in relation to that, what would be very refreshing, I'm not sure if it might happen or not, is for people to say publicly what they're saying privately. You know, if people say this is a good scheme, you know, this is a workable scheme, to actually stand up in front of people and say that, you know, I think that's because you know it's being said out and about. Mm-hmm. To stand up and say that too publicly, you know, stand by. If you believe that's the case, then you owe the public to actually state that. And that's your point of view, and that's fine. And people can make their judgments on that, right? Everyone's entitled, but don't sugarcoat it. Say exactly what you believe.
Yeah, and I think part of the problem, and we understand, you know, like I'll use an example of a man that I do believe, and this may be controversial, but, you know, we'll take Joe McHugh, for example. Joe McHugh did, and, you know, we've had our issues, and we've talked about Joe's role in the Fine Gael stance that was taken. You know, we had the baton handed over between Leo to Micheál Martin, and then back to Leo again, and now he's part of history again, but... Regardless of that, you know, Joe still stood for two things, and it was in consultation with ourselves that we're saying, okay, so if there was anything that could be salvaged, what would they be? The couple of key priority things, and one of them was penalty-free downsizing, a massive compromise that was designed to give people a way forward, even though they shouldn't have had to compromise on the size of their home. For those that worked for, let them go ahead and do it. It's going to be at no additional cost to the state. Joe asked for that. Joe said he wasn't joining the party again until he got that. And the second thing that he stood for was the transfer of eligibility. So if you're a pensioner and you were never going to have the money needed to get out of that nightmare, then at least be able to sell your home, and the grant would go with it, and it might be worth something to somebody. There were two things that were going to cost the state nothing extra, but and it was a fair and reasonable request. He stood his ground on that, and you know he has been you know cast from the party for that.
Yeah,
and
he does vote.
I'll still give credit there.
He does vote in favour. He still votes with the party and votes to keep that party in government.
But what he's not able to do, he's not able to join any of their committees. Okay, so he's still at an arm's length for a man that was a Fine Gael, you know, councillor TD all his life and is stepping away. And I know that that has to probably sour his mouth somewhat, but at least he was prepared to stand up at the end and say, you know, there's two things you could do. But what we then learned, Greg, and this is critically important and people need to understand this, what we learned on them two things alone that was costing the state nothing extra, it was never about costing the state extra. The state didn't want to pay out the money in the first place. And if they had paid out the sum of money that they're going to give to that homeowner anyway for their original size of house and say, take that money now and build whatever size of house you can afford to build, that was money being drawn down from the state account into that homeowner's account that was going to allow them to move forward. And then if you had got, what, 600-700, maybe 2,000-3,000 people then doing that, that was money that was coming out that the department didn't want to pay out in the
first
place.
It's too easy, you're saying.
By them saying, we're not allowing penalty-free downsizing. What they were doing, they were ensuring that only a trickle of homes was ever going to get fixed in Donegal, as opposed to the title and the headline of a 3 to 4 billion euro scheme. They put the title up there, but they put the constraints in place that matured was never going to be drawn down and only a trickle would ever happen. Mm-hmm. Now, Joe, we talked about Charlie McConnell, we have then on the other hand, is around telling everybody that we're getting 100% redress. He's telling it down the country. He even has the neck to tell it out then in the local meetings that he's having in Buchan, our own wee parish down there that he came from himself, and tried to tell his own people. And obviously, it's not washing. So it'll be very interesting to see does Charlie turn up tomorrow night, and if he does, what position does he take on this? Because what he has said up to now has been in complete contrast to what people know was happening on the ground. So it's going to be an interesting evening.
Generally speaking, how does it work then? Did you invite the various elected representatives to submit in written form their opinion, or have you invited them to speak? Or, you know, if it's written, how does the language get challenged and what have you? So what is the format of presenting the people with the political response to the people's document?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, again, what we're intending to do here, we have to understand that we have got opposition and we have in power representation, both there on the night. I think it's right that we probably go the first part of the show, and I'm using the word show because we have no idea how this is going to run yet. We're in control of everything up to the point that you've got people there and you've got politicians there. And we know that, you know, it could get quite fiery and feisty, but we want it to be mannerly. But we also want people to feel that they were able to make their points on the night. But we believe the first half will be probably in and around the whole area of the current scheme. The in-power representative will probably let them go first and tell us what they believe to be the case regards the existing scheme, and see how well that bounces off the people that's on the floor. You know, they can either justify the position they've taken, as you talked about earlier, or they can say, yeah, we have now listened to this, we've seen this, and we want to take a different tact on this, and we'll be pushing for a different tact on this.
Do their voices only get heard if they're in attendance? So say, for instance, hypothetically, Minister McConnell can't attend but sends a document. Is that read into the record, or is that seen as a two-fingered salute to the people in attendance?
Well, I think, you know, the people will make their minds up on that. I think all we'll do is present what is made available to us, be that people in person or be that documentation. And, you know, the people can judge for themselves. But I think at this point in time, with the effort that has gone into this and it being the people's document and in the people's words, that I think that people not being there to stand over it and talk to it themselves, to the people, won't go down particularly well. So that'll be the first part, Greg. And then the second part I think we need to talk about. So that is the opposition gets their chance then to talk about what their position is regards the people's document and what it is that they would do. And I know there's a fear out there. You get all the words and all the rest. But we'll be asking for what they believe would be the evidence of their position being validated from what they've done in the past as well. It'll not be just an easy rock up and say, yeah, we support everything and we'll be looking to do everything that you're asking for in here. We'll also be asking the questions and I'll be chairing it. You know, what would people take here as comfort from the stance that you've done in the past? What have you done in the past that would sort of give the people the confidence that these are not just words but actions this time around? So I think it'll be an interesting evening all around.
And a few people asking, is it streamed? They're from down the county, they can't make it up.
No, it's not streamed, Greg, and I think we've got two reasons for that. Number one, I think there'll be a logistical nightmare involved in that, but number two, I think it's important that people come out hoping that we have got enough of media there, and you know, people sitting in their own homes doesn't give the sense of the emotions of people. That you need to be in there, you need to be in the room, and it's a big room. It'll take up to about 1,000 people there, so there's nobody going to be left standing outside in the cold. You'll all get there. They just have to make the effort of being there on the night at 7 o'clock.
Right, okay, sure, we'll leave it at that. Obviously, we'll be there, we'll get some reaction after the fact as well. I think this could be seen as a sort of a... An important marker on this journey as a whole, not just for those who maybe even can qualify for the scheme that don't think it's 100%, but for farmers, for the likes of the play schools, the community centres, the holiday homeowners, the accidental landlords, the second homeowners, all will be, because it could be perceived as a bit of a divide and conquer here. I remember asking the question, it was way, way, way before this scheme was actually announced. And I was like, well, how would you gauge as a group, not you, the group, how would you gauge if it's okay, if it's acceptable to the people? And I think that's really the point we're arriving at now. And I think the question at the time was, you can just sort of try and get a sense of it. But this really is, I think, the test, what the public think of this, Michael, in terms of this scheme for everyone.
Yeah, and I think that's it. And there is something for everybody here, because we will have people that'll be saying, why would I bother about a people's document that's talking about a proper 100% redress whenever I'm at the sort of halfway through my particular build or rebuild, whatever the case may be. But if you read through that document, you'll see that every benefit that would come from a proper 100% redress as defined in the people's document would be retrospectively applied. Mm-hmm. So the shortfalls will be made up through this. So I think, you know, what our ask would be, their effort has gone into this. It started in the end of October. The people have spoken, and now this is the politician's response. So do you feel that, you know, it's okay to let politicians off the hook? If you do, then don't bother turning up. But if you do believe that politicians now need to man up, woman up, and be there and say what they believe to be their position against that document, then come along and let's ask the questions. But again, if you're not making the effort to be there, then we can't really do a lot more than what we've tried to do so far as campaign leaders. Mm-hmm. This is over to the people now to come and make politicians accountable.
All right, thanks very much for that. Really do appreciate it. We'll have coverage of that, of course, in the morning after, and Michaela's attending that, of course. And then we'll see what other coverage is required as well.
Have you entered our €10,000 home makeover draw? If the answer is yes, then you are now automatically entered into our extra cash giveaway. If the answer is no, then now is the time to enter. Greg Hughes will be ringing one lucky person on Thursday the 28th of March and again on Friday the 5th of April, giving you the chance to win twice. That's not all. You will still have the chance of winning in our main draw of a €10,000 home makeover in association with Foy & Company, plus €5,000 in cash. Go to highlandradio.com now. Click on Win a Home Makeover, answer a simple question, and purchase your ticket. Imagine the possibilities.
Hello, I'm Caoimhe de Barra from Throcra, urging you to return your Throcra Box donation. For families in Malawi whose lives have been devastated by climate change, your support means access to clean, safe water and the tools they need to cope with the ongoing cycle of floods and drought. Your help can make all the difference, because it's not just a box, it's a lifeline. Please visit Throcra.org or call 1-800-408-408. Throcra, together for a just world.
It's hilarious. It's Matches and Old Flames by Tommy Maron, coming to Ungrain on Theatre Letterkenny this Friday and Saturday night.
Your mother told me that when she took you to the beach, not even the tide would take you out.
Don't miss Matches and Old Flames this Friday and Saturday night on Ungrain on Theatre Letterkenny. See ungrainon.com for details.
For a great breakfast, pull into Kelly's Diner in Letterkenny. Not just a great breakfast, but mouth-watering burgers, delicious chicken, succulent steaks, and so much more. For kids, it's not just about pancakes, but a full children's menu to choose from. First Communion and Confirmation celebrations also catered for. Great food and great service every time. At Kelly's Diner, Letterkenny, winner of Best Family Dining at the Highland Radio Hospitality Awards.
New this week in Home Store and More. All ironing boards are all half price. That's right, half price. But better hurry, because when all the half price ironing boards are gone, they're gone. Also, all Pyrex kitchenware is still all half price. But when all the half price Pyrex kitchenware is gone, it's definitely gone. Drop by your local Home Store and More. Visit us online at homestoreandmore.ie. New store now open in Frascati Centre, Blackrock. Home Store and More. A happy home.
Highland Radio weather updates with Ireland West Airport. Time to book the family summer holiday. Fly to Barcelona, Faro, Milan, Mallorca, and much more for a perfect family getaway. Ireland West Airport. Don't just take off, take it easy.
So mostly cloudy for today with outbreaks of rain and drizzle, becoming lighter and patchier as the day goes on. Temperatures 7 to 10 degrees with mostly light to moderate easterly winds. Fresh near the coast. And a man very familiar with the coast is our next guest, Ken O'Sullivan, world-renowned underwater cameraman and filmmaker. Ken O'Sullivan will perform his unique live show Into the Deep, outlining his incredible adventures exploring the North Atlantic Ocean. It's in on Green on Theatre Letterkenny on Wednesday night from 8 p.m. Ken joins us now. Hi, Ken.
Hey, Greg. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic, and it's great to have you on the program. So tell us about this show and how you bring your life and your experiences to a live audience.
Well, come here, Greg. I don't know who came up with that term, world-renowned. I certainly didn't anyway, but thank you. I've been really excited to do this for a few years because obviously I've been making documentaries about the ocean and our seas in Ireland for 19 years now. And people might have seen our last series, North Atlantic, The Dark Ocean. But, a live show is so much different because you can interact with the audience. So, you know, I talk about my family history on a small island off Kerry for 250 years as fishermen. And, yeah, and then, you know, swimming with some of the largest animals ever to have lived in the Atlantic, some of the biggest sharks, and, you know, the abundance and beautiful wildlife that we have in our waters in Ireland. So it's wonderful because, you know, I play videos and then I tell the stories of that and interact with the audience as opposed to a TV documentary where obviously you can't interact with people.
And anyone on land's never experienced what you've experienced, even if they stood beside an elephant, if you understand where I'm going with this, right? So you're in their world. We see this on our TV. It could be a 32-inch TV or a 60, but it's still just we're seeing it through a screen. What's it like being down in the water in this world with these enormous creatures?
Well, I mean, look, you know, I think most everybody loves to get into the sea, you know, obviously at different levels. But, you know, when you drop below the surface and you dive in Ireland, you know, diving, snorkeling, it doesn't come naturally to anybody. It takes a little bit of work. But when you do get comfortable with being in the water, it's absolutely amazing. I mean, it's as close as human beings as we can come to flying because you're moving in three dimensions. You know, you're left, right, you're up, down. But so being in the water is beautiful. And I love that. But it's funny you mentioned elephants. So I've been in the water with fin whales, which are the second largest animal ever to have lived. Blue whales, the biggest. Fin whales are 80,000 tons, which is the weight, I believe, if my maths are correct, of 15 elephants. Blue whales can be up to 120 tons. So that's almost, what was that, nearly 20 full-sized elephants. They're enormous. They're the size and weight of two articulated lorries. But it's terrifying, and I'm very afraid. And, you know, I suppose I've spent nearly 20 years learning how to do this safely. And I do what I do to try and document these animals and tell their stories. So it's an incredible privilege, to be honest.
Yeah, for sure. And you're doing firsts as well. It's back, what, about 7 years ago that you filmed 35 basking sharks engaging in a courtship ritual. What was so unique about that in terms of the documentation of it? Like, what were they? I was going to ask, what are they doing? They're courting, right? I don't want to get too dirty.
Yeah.
Well, but I mean, like, what are you? I know that I'm only messing. They're just having dinner and drinks. But like, what talks me about that experience and the visuals of it?
Yeah, look, it was insane. I mean, I spent 10 years looking for the fertile areas in our ocean, and we eventually found these patches, thermal fronts they're called, where you get an upwelling of cold, nutrient-rich water somewhere offshore, anywhere between, you know, 8, 20, 30 kilometres out. And when we found it, every time we went to this area, we had something. But the first time we went, we found these basking sharks in Circle, which is now known as a Taurus. And it was the first time it had been filmed anywhere in the world. And we went to the world expert on basking sharks, a guy called Professor David Sims in Southampton. And they'd seen it. The hunters in Cornwall had seen it in the 50s. It had been seen from a research plane in Canada in 1998. But because nobody was in the water, and I could see being in the water, there was an even mix of males and females. So I knew something was very different. And we wrote a paper with David and a couple of other people, which came out a couple of years ago. And thankfully, I'd like to think it helped to have basking sharks legally protected in Ireland. Now, a lot of people did a lot of work, including great man up your way, Emmett Johnson and the Irish Basking Shark Group, who have done research for decades. Mm-hmm. But the courtship was just insane. They're going round and round in circles, males and females, just endlessly through maybe three layers of them. And this has been happening for tens of thousands, millions of years. But I can't say I was lucky, because when you do 10 years work to find something, then, you know, it's hard.
You make your own luck. Yeah. Yeah. And what is the biggest animal, creature, mammal off our coast, that is regularly off our coast within, and sort of what proximity to it? I kind of am going back to fifth or sixth class in Lahey National School here to try and wreck my brain, but a sperm whale, is it? Basking shark? What?
Well, we have blue whales. They pass through our waters in late summer, early autumn, and that's the largest animal ever to have lived.
And when we say our waters, because, you know, our waters can be 300 or 400 miles out or whatever it might be, like, how close to shore realistically might a blue whale come?
So they tend to come to what we call the edge of the continental shelf. So that could be about 40 miles west of Mayo is the closest part. Mm-hmm. And they migrate down there in the autumn time. But I mean, we'll regularly see fin whales have been seen off the coast of Waterford, you know, even in Bunmahan Bay, 200 metres from the shore. Now that's up to 24 metre long animal. But, if we forget about size for a moment, I suppose, I mean, we have 40 species of sharks in our waters.
Yeah.
I can find no record of anybody being attacked by a shark in the water in Ireland. No. Incredible record.
Were the greater threat to them, and I suppose in endangering and harming their habitat, it's also having an impact on us. And ocean conservation, obviously, I think anyone like you who sees it firsthand and understands how it works understands the importance of it. So part of your show, do you focus on talking a little bit about that, or much about that,
about conservation?
Yeah,
absolutely. Look, we've covered conservation since I started in 2005. And it's great that, you know, big iconic series like BBC's and National Geographic's have discovered it in recent years. But, I don't want to be negative, but it really is recent years when they started to tell these stories. Look, you know, my family survived the famine because, you know, my father always said, because we lived on an island, because we could feed ourselves from the sea. And I grew up fishing with trammel nets and old school methods. And then, you know, I've kind of come full circle into being an underwater cameraman and a diver. But when you see these stories in the sea, I can't but not tell them. I have to tell them. And, you know, humans are killing 270 million sharks every year.
That's
there was the Spanish trawler arrested in off Cork 3 or 4 years ago. They had the fins of 5,000 blue sharks on board.
Unbelievable.
I mean, it's unbelievable. And you say, well, what's the importance of these animals? Okay, well, you know, sharks, we don't like them very much. Well, actually, it's usually important because they play a very, very key role in the ecosystem. They're in what we might call an apex predator. And when you take them out, everything that's below them then maybe starts to overgraze the ocean and starts to overfeed. And you can upset the balance where an ecosystem can actually start to collapse. So it's really, really important.
It's funny too, because you're talking about the impact you're having with what your show. It'd be interesting, perhaps this study is the impact the film Jaws had on sharks, turning them into this bad thing. I mean, shark attacks are so rare, they actually make the news if it happens off Bondi Beach. You know what I mean? It's in the sun here or something like that, or the mirror or whatever it might be. But, you know, they don't deserve the rap that they get. And I just wonder if, you know, the fear of them and what have you was popularized by things like Jaws.
But usually, did you see Spielberg came out about 2 years ago and apologized for Jaws?
Oh, right, okay.
I tell you, a couple of interesting stories. Well, the first thing is that annually there are about 6 people in the world killed by sharks, and that's almost exclusively in Australia or perhaps Florida, places like that. And there are 400 species of sharks, or about 3 who are aggressive, but they're not necessarily aggressive to people. They're territorial animals. But the guy who wrote the book that Jaws was based on, Peter Benchley, and also the screenplay, sometime after Jaws came out, he came face to face with a great white shark, and suddenly he thought, if this shark takes me, it'll be natural justice. But of course it didn't. And he realized this was a beautiful, sensitive animal, and he spent the rest of his life making documentaries about shark conservation, the guy who wrote Jaws. You know, I remember when Jaws came out, I was very young, and people were saying, oh, you know, millions of people never got in the sea again. But actually what happened is, as you said, Greg, it generated a huge prejudice towards these animals, yeah, where people think, you know, it's okay to kill them because they're monsters.
Okay, Into the Deep takes place in On Green on Theatre Wednesday night at 8 p.m. So just in a minute, do you want to sort of, I think really, you know, anyone who's any passing interest in this subject at all, and because of where we live, we all do, right? But just, do you want to tell us a little bit how you tell the story or what the experience is, Ken, for those just ready to pick up the phone and book a ticket?
Yeah, so I mean, I talk about my family history in a coastal community and the culture that I was lucky to inherit within coastal communities, but also about filming these animals. And we've done lots of filming off Donegal, spent times in Port Salon and Fanad and Malin, and actually filmed probably, I believe, for the first time in Ireland, first person to be in the water with a poor beagle shark. They're very rare. And we filmed that after 9 years of efforts, thanks to our good friends in Donegal. So talking about these stories, but also giving good news stories and trying to educate people. And lots of teenagers and kids come along and, you know, they're great for asking questions. So, an hour and a quarter of that.
Fantastic stuff. There are a few tickets still available. Ken, thank you very much. We look forward to welcoming you back to Donegal. Take care of yourself.
Thanks for having me.
No problem. That's Ken O'Sullivan, filmmaker. His show, Into the Deep, it's live in on Green On Theatre, Letterkenny, of course, on this Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Okay, thank you so much to all of you who stuck with us for throughout the show. It's been really enjoyable Monday. We're going to do it all again tomorrow on the 9 till noon show. So if you are listening, by the way, on the podcast, or if you are listening overnight, feel free to stay in touch with us, WhatsApp or text, but preferably email comments@highlandradio.com, and we can pick them up and include them in tomorrow's show. But for me, Greg Hughes, and Caroline Orr, who produces the show, and Caroline Wilkins working on the Shannon. I went for the double and I still messed it up. Shannon Wilkins also working on the show. Have a great Monday. John Bresson's coming up around the Northwest after the news at 12.
Are you tired of how you feel? Despite diet and exercise, are you struggling to lose weight? Do you need help to achieve your weight loss goals? At Letterkenny Medics Private Clinic, we are offering a free consultation to ascertain if you are suitable for treatment on our weight management program. All consultations are confidential and completed by an experienced doctor. We are open 7 days per week from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. to facilitate your needs. To book an appointment, go to letterkennymedics.ie. Letterkenny Medics. We listen if you want to talk.
Looking for the best place in the Northwest to get a bed or mattress? Restex Beds and Mountaintop Letterkenny has a great selection and great prices. Restex Beds has everything you need for a good night's sleep. Visit them today and sleep better tonight.
Colm here from Sweeney's Home Value Builders Providers, Lettermac Award and Derry Beg. Are you starting a new build or planning a renovation anytime soon? Why not give us a call today for quotation for all your building needs? Whether it's steel or insulation, timber or slates, we have it all at Sweeney's.